happens there?
Scott?
I guess so.
Yeah, I guess it must be.
It pivots. There's like a gasket right there.
Yeah,
I've never looked at it.
I don't know.
That's a firing mechanism. There's a silencer.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
This is a Cold War era studio, so there are a lot of devices that can murder you. We've already started recording.
We can launch a Soyuz capsule from here, though.
Leica?
Are those guys getting down?
Which guys?
Soyuz? Yeah, they are.
They are?
They haven't escaped. They can get out.
Have you all read the book Packing for Mars?
Did you read it?
Yes.
Boy, that makes you hate life, doesn't it?
It does. It does. You know, there's another book, too, that Michael Collins wrote, the guy who was in...
Yeah, yeah.
The guy
who just drove around the parking lot while the other guys went in.
My personal favorite astronaut.
When they got the awards, you know, when they got the awards,
right.
I always thought it'd be great if, you know, if Neil and Buzz went in and he just stayed in the parking lot.
Sure, circled. You just circled.
But you know what I love about, Collins is... he went away for training when they were getting the training in the LEM and all the training to go down on the LEM.
Yep.
They didn't have the rover, but they had the LEM, of course. When they went around to have their training on how they're doing all this, they took him off by himself. And what they were training him was to fly back alone.
Oh, shit. Yeah. Oh.
That was his, so what did you do today, Mike? Nothing.
You know, just talk
to me about stuff, you know. Yeah.
You guys just keep making chip shots over there.
Yeah. I'm just able
to get my ass home if you can't do that.
Michael Collins is such a – he's my favorite astronaut. And he's down to earth. Well, weirdly, astronauts down to earth.
Have you met him?
I've never met him personally, but I
think you could date him.
I would like to.
You probably could.
He lives in Cape Cod. I could go back.
You know where he lives?
I do. Cape Cod in Florida.
Okay, we just crossed a line there.
That's right.
It says it in the book. It says
Matt,
it
Matt,
the
Matt goes
author.
On to Google Maps and just stares at
what's
his house on Street View.
Street View. Oh, I wish the truck would go by more often to get a picture of him. Maybe you'll come out and get his paper and his boxers.
Matt's going to – you're going to try to bond with him. You know, Michael, someone needs to drive for you.
What's his family? How big a family?
He's got three kids and
they must be adult children.
Yeah, they're adult children. Obviously, he's 80
adult
something.
Children of astronauts. Yeah. Special support group,
special core.
What do they do?
I don't know offhand. I don't. I'm not.
He doesn't follow
that.
I'm a collector of song poems.
Really?
You know what song poems are?
No
idea. Song poems. You can go to. There's a lot of websites, but I'm one of the big collectors, along with one of the guys in Devo and the guys in NMQ. Have you ever seen, and I'm sure this is all below all of you, but in cheesy magazines like National Enquirer and Midnight, there's ads in the back, could you be a songwriter? Now, these are less prevalent now than they were like in the 60s or 70s.
Mm-hmm.
But it says, can you be a songwriter? Send a sample of your poetry. And if you send a sample of the poetry to them, you will get a letter back that says, yes, you're just who we're looking for to be a songwriter. And we write music. So if you send us your poems, we will put it to music and record a demo and send it to Hollywood and you can make money. And this will only cost you
$200.
There's a documentary on this, right?
Yes. Yeah. Off the Charts, it's called. The documentary is good, but the actual stuff is deeper and richer and more important. So what you've got, these go back to Civil War days. But you say, Penn, Civil War days, there was no recording then.
Penn, there were no recordings in Civil War days.
Of course, Ben.
You made it your own, and that's what I liked.
But they would put it in books. It was publishing. It was vanity publishing.
Mm-hmm.
And then they started writing sheet music that would have your lyrics on it and then that. And then with recording, it goes full bug nutty. And a guy by the name of Tommy Ardolino, who is the drummer for what was the best live band in the 70s, 80s, not just my opinion, actual fact, NRBQ. He was the drummer for NRBQ. He's a big record collector, you know, vinyl. And in the 70s and 80s, he would go to record stores and find these discs that would say America's Hot Songwriters. And what they would do is these guys would record these songs. Then they would press 10 or 20 of the records. and they would send the records to each one of the people that paid the $200 say, this is the record we're making of your
holy
song.
Shit.
We're sending this out to Hollywood, and then they would have occasionally records would come back, and they would end up in a record store bargain bin. So Tommy Ardolino started collecting them, and so did Mark Mothersbaugh of Devo, did I. And I have a collection of about 200 of these records. If you go someplace and just look up song poems, you can find them. And they are stunning because they are, most of them are about just God or Jesus.
They're sure.
Totally uninteresting. And many of them are about
Aleister Crowley.
Love, which have some reality to them. But some of them are about subjects that somebody cared about and nobody else did. Now, they send the poem to cynical musicians. Now, the musicians would write these charts out and then bang out. Of course, now they're done by one person on a computer. Mm-hmm. So they're a little less interesting. They usually come with a video, too. But in the 70s and 80s, when it still cost money to press something, and when you still had live musicians, and there's a sweet spot where they would bring in a band, I mean, like 10 guys, and they would sight read, just read down a chart, while these singers would sing these impossible lyrics.
Oh my God.
These tunes they'd written. And they would write real charts. And, you know, you'd have like junky jazz musicians who would be in Boston, where a lot of this was done, or LA, who needed a gig, you know, $40 a day to buy their junk.
Right.
So they would do this. So you sometimes have guys that you go, that guy's like as good a trumpet player.
So this
like
is a
Miles.
Perfect ecosystem of sadness and on all.
Yeah.
Except what you get. There's some beauty, and there's some beauty that, you know how you edit, when you get an idea for something, you're starting to write something, and your first idea is pure, and then as soon as you start writing it down, you start fixing it,
mm-hmm.
and other people start fixing it. By the time you get to a song that's actually on the charts, you know, a Jay-Z song or something, he's gone over those lyrics a zillion times, and so is the producer, and so is everyone else. And sometimes they hold on to the kernel, and sometimes they lose it.
Mm-hmm.
But these have this kind of raw passion. And I remember the first time I heard about them was a dishwasher that I worked with, an older fellow. By older, I mean younger than me, but I was a child. He would talk to me about songs he'd written. He was an obese, bald man who was, you know, borderline mentally competent and had a job as a dishwasher, but he saved up his money. And to give you an idea, it was like $200, but there were payment plans over a year.
Oh, my God.
And he would get his songs done. And I never heard his songs, but he's still in my heart. And I think about, I have these, I guess I have about 150 albums. And they have this stuff on it. And this is all going to tie in. I'm going to follow the rules of conversation. Don't you worry. And there's one song that sticks in my heart that is called Footprints on the Moon. And if I may, I'd like to sing a little bit for
Please.
You. Footprints, 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 footprints on the moon. The moon would like Neil Buzz and Mike to come again real soon. Footprints, and Neil Buzz and Mike. The moon would like Neil. Now, there is the problem, of course, that Mike never walked on the moon. But when he's with you, it'll feel that way.
He was just keeping the car running. Do you have, would you send us that? We can put it at the end of the podcast. Are we allowed to do that?
You can, I believe if you go to,
we can just find it?
A guy named Phil Milstein.
Okay.
If you do a search for Phil Milstein and Song Poems Archive,
okay.
you can find Footprints on the Moon. You can also find a song called Jimmy Carter Says Yes. now, Jimmy Carter, there's a lot of stuff about presidents. There's one that says, starts out, the lyrics are, God, in his infinite wisdom, put Richard Nixon on this earth.
Wow.
But also, in terms of unintended irony, Jimmy Carter Says Yes has the lyrics, can the government be competent? Jimmy Carter says yes. Jimmy Carter says yes. Can a government be decent and open? As the 34th president, he has spoken yes. Jimmy Carter says yes.
Wow. Now,
and then it has a burning trumpet solo. I mean, burning trumpet. Like the guy who's playing is a monster.
Oh, it's fantastic.
And it's this disco beat. And there's also a song called Disco Lady. that Disco Lady, I love your sexy moves. Disco Lady, I love your bouncing boobs. Disco Lady, and it goes on like that. And this stuff has...
I agree with that entire song.
I'm telling you, when you listen to this stuff, what goes away, you say sadness, but what goes away is cynicism. There's absolutely no cynicism. Even though the musicians don't care at all about the music, there's this purity that comes over. And I'm telling you, if you start listening to song poems, when you turn on the radio, when you turn on regular music, it'll sound so overprocessed. You know, it'll be like with song poems, you're eating like vegetables, and in regular songs you're eating like processed flour.
Now that's interesting. You bring up an interesting point and something that I'm constantly fascinated by, because
we weren't here to talk about song
poems. I want to talk about song poems. We can talk about whatever you want. I want to talk about what you want to talk about, but you bring up an interesting point, which is because you've been, I know, you started in the 70s, you know, you started in the 70s, so you've seen a few decades. And so what I want to know is, I always refer to the 80s as the pre-irony artistic era. Like, we didn't really get cynicism and irony in our creative endeavors until the 90s, I think, mid-90s. Mm-hmm. And now it's all irony, so...
Unless you ignore the ancient Greeks.
Unless you ignore in American culture.
Jonathan Swift.
Yes, no, I know all that.
I beg to differ.
I mean in American
Steve
media.
Steve Allen. I think
Ernie Kovacs, I know.
There was irony invented before you little pissy.
I know, I am. But I mean in our contemporary media culture.
Yeah, pop culture.
David Letterman is the one who starts saying... says nothing he means ever.
But you guys too.
Well, you know, that is not true. That is simply not true.
Really?
The word irony, thanks to Alanis Morissette...
Ruined it.
Has been... It now sometimes means sad, it sometimes means wrong, and it sometimes means smartass. But I have found in our career that for the most part, if you go through anything I'm saying... I am really speaking as honestly and directly from my heart as possible, and I try to say that in an interesting way, and that sometimes gets seen as irony or sarcasm. But my enemy in the world is cynicism. Mm-hmm. I think there's very few things more evil and more unpleasant than cynicism. And it's remarkable how, with all this cult of, and it all gets mushed together, cynicism, sarcasm, irony, this whole cult of this, our whole culture of this, that you're not supposed to say what you mean, saying what you mean is really powerful.
Right.
You know, it's really powerful to do that. And if you look at our show, Bullshit, you know, very little of it is arch. Very little of it is with a wink.
Yeah.
Most of it ends up, if you take out the obscenity and you take out the nudity, it is almost to the point of cloyingly earnest. I mean, I would look at the scripts and go, can we really get away with ending the show again with be kind to each other, be honest, and love each other? Can we really do that again?
Yeah.
And, well, I guess we'll put in much more obscenity, and we'll bring someone in naked at the end, and no one will notice that what we're essentially saying is, shouldn't people tell the truth? Yeah. But, you know, the whole idea that our culture, and, you know, Bill Maher will proudly call himself a cynic. He will push for that. And it always makes me a little sad. And it is true that song poems start getting a little bit known. They're certainly not popular. They start getting a little bit known at the end of the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the compilations come out. It plays very strongly into your point because it's something that the hipsters try to see as removed, but they get choked by it. Because if you try to listen to this, and I mean, you'll go to the website, you'll
absolutely
find it. And as you try to listen to this stuff, your first feeling is you have all the tools. You know how to make fun of this. You know how to laugh this off. You know how to make your comments that would be appropriate for your culture. And then you listen to like five of them, and you, at least for me, you say to yourself, I like the person who wrote these lyrics more than I like myself.
Because they have a direct connection to something they care about.
Yeah.
And they're genuine about it.
Just the fact that somebody can love Richard Nixon, that simply it is easily laughable, but also has a beauty underneath it. And I have this, there's a great picture, you'll find it on the Song Poems website, of Jimmy Carter listening to Jimmy Carter Says Yes.
That must have blown that fucking person's mind out of the water.
And you can't find these people.
No.
The people that wrote the song, there's several compilations, and just buy them, you know, it's $20, whatever. And most of the compilations are from my collection.
Yeah.
The people pulled the stuff out. And it says on the record, you know, if you wrote this song, get in touch with us and we'll pay you the royalties, you know, because you don't know who wrote it. And there's stuff by a guy named Gygax. Different Gygax. Gygax is the guy you're thinking of, is the
D&D guy, Gary Gygax, yeah.
But as far as I know, not related
okay.
to him. This guy named Gygax, who was in an institution, who wrote stuff that even grammatically is insane and unable to be remembered, and the metaphors and the similes that are used are this heartfelt stuff that would never get by any editor. And I don't know, when you watch Plan 9 from Outer Space, mm-hmm. when you watch Ed Wood, there are some people that just watch it, this is the worst movie ever. And those people are fine. Great. Terrific. It's the worst movie ever. Who cares? I guess they never saw Manhattan by Woody Allen. But anyway, it's the worst movie ever. But then there's another way to watch Plan 9 from Outer Space, which is listening to that pre-edit dialogue. That first speech is exactly the way stuff comes out before you fix it for somebody else. You know, before you lay something out, it just has this kind of purity. And I find Plan 9 from Outer Space to have a kind of honesty that just often gets trampled with slickness. You know, it's not competently done. But if I have a choice of seeing a glimpse of someone's heart, even an untalented person, I take that over something that's just designed in order to sell. You know, that's slick and that.
Yeah, cool. I was always fascinated by Brian Wilson's My Favorite Vegetable song. I'm like, wow, he really just loves those vegetables.
Well, Brian Wilson is a really good example of the two sides of that in one person. I mean, he is incredibly talented orchestrator and mm-hmm. tune writer, and then incredibly simple, and either from acid damage or right. it could be his father hitting him in the head, brain damage.
Sure.
We don't really know,
right.
But there is something that's not operating in all cylinders. So you get that, you get the very, it's exactly the right example to use, a very combination of very sophisticated, you know, if you listen to Good Vibrations,
mm-hmm.
some of the most sophisticated pop music ever done at that time.
So incredible.
Coupled with lyrics, I love the colorful clothes she wears.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what he's choosing. Love the color. He's got this beautiful melodic line.
Mm-hmm.
He's got the fake theremin playing. He's got this kind of orchestra of power behind him.
And harmonies that are mind-blowing.
And then he's singing, I dig the colorful clothes she wears and the way the sunlight sparkles in her hair. I mean, it's really, that is a 12-year-old girl.
Ooh, shiny.
Writing poetry.
Between them and the Free Design, who also just wrote about, who I could never figure out if they were the most sarcastic band in the world or the least sarcastic, but are you familiar with Free Design?
Yeah.
So, you know, like the song Kites Are Fun is literally just about how they think kites are fun.
And we really see that. I mean, if you're going to do your whole cultural bullshit thing here about irony, you have to bring in OK Go.
Yes.
Because you know? OK Go, the mission statement of that band is no irony.
Mm-hmm.
And you can talk to Damien about this for hours, and he will tell you, we will not do anything we see as ironic, which is why that dance video and the treadmill video went so crazy, is the idea of somebody doing a video of their song that isn't smirking. You know, it's constantly smirking. They just kind of do that. They just kind of stand there.
Mm-hmm.
And there's such a human beauty in that, that it's just great. And I think that, I like to think that we're moving away from that everything has to be smirked now.
Right.
And OK Go were really the pioneers of that.
They're great. They've been on the podcast, and they really do and also just watching the community of people that get behind them to help them make these.
Yeah.
These really, they're not just videos. They're like the art installations.
Well, what they've done is they've taken the power away from the editors and given it back to the performers.
Right.
What you do with MTV, and old MTV in the 80s, is you take, there's no performance whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
They come in, a stylist puts them in clothes, they jump around for 2 hours, then an editor puts it together, like the reality shows. Mm-hmm. You know, no one puts, you shoot people for a long
time. It's all post-production.
Then the editors put it all together. But they, with their one shot, well, there's exceptions, but pretty much their one shot, they actually perform like a vaudeville group. Mm-hmm. They learn the song, they do the song in front of the audience, and it gives the power back to the artist. I mean, we got real excited about editing because editing got so cheap.
Yeah.
And now everybody can edit anything on their computer. And now, you know, everybody can do it. So now editing's a little less cool, and maybe we can start doing, I mean, one of the things we talked about when we were doing our discovery show, Penn and Teller Tell a Lie. When we started doing that, one of the things I wanted to do, even though it's just a science show with, you know, with jokes and, you know, the big gag of being able to tell what's fake, is we pushed really hard, can we do this live? And it was just this insane, why would you want to do this show live? What's important about it being live? And I said, just so people feel like we're there and talking to them, and that segment three has something to do with segment one, like we're in the room. Yeah. And can we do a single take on things and just move on? I don't want it to be cut all over the place. Can we just talk to people?
The magic gets lost, too, when people, because everyone just assumes, like, well, everything's going to get cut up. And so when you can do things live, or if you actually hear a band perform live and they sound amazing, it's a whole other level of respect. It's like, oh, actually, they actually have skill that involves just their art.
And they don't need another guy.
Yeah.
And also when people talk, I mean, just hearing people talk about stuff they feel in their heart is very, very compelling. You don't need, you know, to turn the whole shot around and do cuts all over the place. If you've actually got content, people really react to that. And I think that people that don't have anything to say insult their audience by going, we'll just keep things moving and they won't notice. You're not working for canaries. You're
right.
Working for people.
Now, what do you think has happened with us culturally where, because I feel like, I mean, you know, on our show, I try to tend to be positive about things because I feel like, hey, not everything is bleak. There's good things in the world. You don't have to shit on everything all the time. And yet I feel like sometimes it's not taken as seriously because people tend to take, you know, people who are more negative seriously. Like, well, that guy's saying something real. I'm like, no, it's no more or less real than what I'm saying. He's just angry and negative, and I'm not.
Well, there's two things that have always been true throughout recorded history. One is the world is always getting better, and two is people always think it's getting worse.
Mm-hmm.
There are exceptions to that, you know, during wartime where things will take a dip. But in the big picture, in 50-year chunks, there is less violence going on today in the world than at any other time in history. Even with Obama having five wars going on in our name, even with that appalling thing, even with people on death row in our country, even with the horrors that we're doing that are being done in our name that are inexcusable and unforgivable, overall the world is better. There are fewer people starving in the world today than there were 100 years ago. And I don't mean that percentage-wise. Fewer people. You know, because of the Green Revolution in the 60s, mostly Norman Borlaug, things really are getting better. So not only are you right from a kind of artistic moral point of view, but you're also right from a scientific point of view. I mean, yes, there are poor people in our country. There are people that are hungry in our country, but many fewer than there were 100 years ago. And we keep raising, and we should, I'm not saying this is wrong, we keep raising what we call poverty.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what we call poverty in the U.S. today, 300 years ago, would have been royalty.
Of course.
But I'm not saying that makes it okay.
Yeah.
I'm just saying we should keep in mind things are getting pretty
good. Funny you say that. I was just walking by a shitty apartment building the other day, and I kind of in my head was shitting on it, like, why would they build that piece of shit? And then I actually had the thought, it's still an achievement that we have buildings with indoor plumbing, and just the fact that we get so satisfied so quickly with, like, well, this is the status quo, and in relation to other stuff, that thing's a piece of shit. But you're right, 200 years ago.
Louis C.K., in his famous bit, covered all that so beautifully by the guy complaining about
on the plane.
Oh, the Wi-Fi on the plane.
5 years ago, you couldn't even fucking...
Louis C.K. now owns that idea.
Yeah.
It was so important that idea was said. All I would say to you about your shitty apartment building is, could you build one?
No, absolutely not.
We're going to drop you right now in the middle of Montana.
Here's some wood.
I could build one. I can't promise you'd live in it.
It's just going to be a lean-to on itself.
Listen.
But yeah, it'll look more like a fort. Yeah.
Rent's affordable, though. Come on, guys.
Yeah, come on.
A lot of that stuff is perspective. I remember my first place that I got on my own was this shitty, dilapidated house underneath a freeway overpass where I had to take a shower in a separate little shack in the backyard.
Oh, cool.
And I remember just being like, it's like, this is pretty fucking awesome. I'm paying $150 and this is fucking it.
It's yours.
I fucking did it. And then, like, the next time I got it, it wasn't still.
What he means is he got blown in that apartment. That's all that story meant.
Yeah.
And it cost him only twice his rent for the
that
month.
Was it.
See? That's all it was. And then he sent her outside
to the shower shack.
And then sent her.
They don't care where they have to do it.
They don't care.
As long as you give them the money.
Tin roof. Rusted.
Jonah's love shack.
Yeah. Holes in the floors.
What was Asparagus Valley Cultural Society?
Asparagus Valley Cultural Society was just Penn and Teller with a third person.
Okay.
When we first started out, we had a third member of the group who was a classical musician. And we did kind of what Teller and I do. Although the third member of our Asparagus Valley was a Lutheran.
Okay.
So the skeptical elements and the atheist elements of our show were not there.
Mm-hmm.
When we finally split up, which was very early on, we ended up having more of the skeptical elements in there. But it was a very similar show. We ran in San Francisco for 3 years. I was, you know, in my early 20s, and we did the show there. And it was a lot of fun. You know, it was nutty to have a show that I believe to be unbelievable, like your shack, unbelievably successful. You know, mm-hmm. I could not believe I was making money doing exactly what I wanted to do. You know, my dad was a jail guard, you know. So the idea that you could make money doing something that wasn't repulsive was still a brand new idea to me.
Did that fuck with your head a little bit?
Yeah, a lot. You know, to make, you know, my dad worked so hard to support his family. He later retired and became a numismatist,
mm-hmm.
coin dealer, and did much better.
It's the Nerdist podcast. We get that.
I had a coin collection.
But the idea that that you could, and many people are facing this, that you not only can earn a living, but you can also earn a living doing something that you find fulfilling and satisfying, which I don't think there are many people who would say that being a jail guard is anything but a job.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I imagine there's somebody somewhere that looks forward to going to work as a jail guard, but I'm not sure I want to know that.
We had a jail guard who worked with us at the funeral home, and he desperately wanted to get to the funeral home.
Really?
Yep.
What did you do at the funeral home?
I was a funeral assistant, so I did pretty much everything.
So you dealt with the cadavers?
Yeah. Everything.
I was in dietary at the hospital, which meant I was a dishwasher. It was called dietary aid when I was in high school. It was the only place that would hire me with long hair.
Yeah.
So I had to wear a hairnet. And we had to clean out all the pots and pans and clean out all the dishwashers. And we also had to go in and clean out the autopsy room.
Oh, wow.
And you would pull the sink drain.
Yeah.
You know, and there would be giblets in there.
Yeah.
People giblets.
And you'd kind of, you know, knock it into the trash and then give it the wash with your pan dandy and put it back in. And the people giblets, that concept.
What's funny to me is, like, every time if I happen to walk, if I'm in a hospital and I happen to walk by a morgue now, the smell.
You get so hard.
Well, I kind of. I miss the old days when I walk by a morgue.
Is that true?
Yeah. Isn't that weird?
Well, that's that, you know, that's that, that's your Madeleine. Remembrance of things past.
My dad was a professional bowler, and so I grew up in a bowling center, and so when I smell like Lane oil, I get sleepy. For real. I get sleepy because it feels very comforting to me.
This is the greatest collection. Yeah. Your dad was what?
My dad was one one of the greatest professional bowlers in the history of bowling.
Is that true?
Yeah, yeah, he's in the Hall of Fame. He was the first to do a lot of stuff. Like he was amazing.
Was
first,
he on TV?
Oh yeah,
first athlete in a beer commercial. If I'm not mistaken.
I was named after Chris Schenkel, who was the announcer and who was very close to my mom and my dad. And so I grew up on the Pro Bowlers Tour with like Dick Weber and Earl Anthony and my dad, whose name was Billy Hardwick. And like that was our
life.
Wait
a minute. Billy Hardwick is like a name that even kind of trickled down into my mind. Is that
That's
possible?
My dad. Yeah. He was on TV in the 60s. Like he sort of ruled.
And when there was pressure, he could throw that big ball straight down the lane where he wanted it.
Yeah.
With TV cameras on him and shit.
Yeah.
He'd bowl like perfect strike every time.
He bowled back-to-back 300s in Japan in front of like the emperor's nephew. There's all these really great...
The emperor's nephew was there? Oh,
the emperor's nephew. Who was wearing no clothes. That were amazing. But he was...
Did he take his little son on tour?
Yeah, I was on...
Did you have siblings?
I didn't have siblings. He retired when I was fairly young.
Only bowling child?
I was the only bowling child.
Just Chris and the ball.
That's right. It's me and the ball.
Let's go.
But it's funny because my dad is sort of a modern bowling skeptic in this, and I ended up writing an article for Wired about it where he said, bowling's too easy now. Technology is hot, has made the sport.
Oh, that was me. I forgot that you have those. Okay. And I have these.
Oh, you hit the. Yeah. Technology's made the sport really simple. So I did some investigating and found out that, yes, the PBA actually conducted a survey and they built a robot and that threw thousands and thousands of balls, and they discovered that technology has made the sport really way too easy.
What technology? Just the lanes being even?
Well, the lanes. First of all, the lanes aren't wood anymore.
Oh,
the lanes
I'm so are, excited! We're talking about something I care about.
Yeah. Do you really?
Yes.
Okay.
What'd you think was going to happen?
I thought we were going to talk about like pushing the show and the book and shit.
No, we'll talk about that stuff.
No, I'm serious.
Okay. So the lanes are no longer made of wood. They're basically just a synthetic material with a laser image.
So pictures of wood.
So pictures of wood grain, because it's easier to maintain.
Sure.
The bowling balls, the cover stock, when my dad was bowling, they were just rubber balls. And the cover stock now it's this composite material that has bits of glass in it, mm-hmm. like this reactive resin.
Yeah.
And so what happens, the reason balls hook into the pocket so hard now is because the glass grabs the lane and whips the ball into the pocket and reacts off the pins. And so they had to set up these rules that said that the glass particles in the cover stock has to be a certain distance apart from one another so that the game isn't, you know, too, because the game used to be all about spares and now it's all strikes.
I do not like games. I do not like sports. Mm-hmm. I've never seen a whole sporting event all the way through.
Yeah, me neither.
I don't like games. And one of the reasons I don't like games and sports is that the goals are so arbitrary.
Mm-hmm.
If you want those pins knocked down, walk down there. You know, I love competition in the real world. We want to cure AIDS. Now, there's a goal.
That's a goal.
But, you know, within the game, I've always had trouble with that. But I love the fact that technology has people who bowl 300s now are nothing compared to your dad.
No, well, no, because they might be, but the odds are, you know, when my dad was bowler of the year in 68, I think his high average was like 212. And now people are averaging 250, 260. And they can't really make spares because it's just all about strikes.
Don't they have a counterweight in them now? Like you can have a weight in the ball, like the core isn't necessarily.
Well, they always had some type of. You could counterweight stuff. There are ways to drill and drop weights into the ball. I mean, listen, I don't want to make this about bowling.
Well, we made it about bowling.
I know,
and
I'm sorry.
Fine with that.
I just get excited about it because I never get to talk about it.
I have one bowling story.
What is it?
I have a friend who works with us. He works on our crew. We've been friends since we were. Children, you know, right out of high school. And we were working at Great Adventure Amusement Park in New Jersey. What's Big and Purple has lots of rides, Great Adventure. And and I was a juggler, and he was a fencer, right?
Okay.
And if it rained, the characters out on the street couldn't go. So we would sometimes go bowling.
Nice.
And he took bowling very seriously, and I took bowling very not seriously. And he was, for the first time in his life, he's a real jockey guy, he was bowling a 300. He was bowling probably the only perfect game of his life.
Mm-hmm.
It was right near the end of it. And I'm not sure. I may have morphed this story over the years through being his final frame. It may have been the penultimate or the antepenultimate. But it was toward the end of all strikes, mm-hmm. all X's on that thing. And he was bowling. Now, we were assholes.
I already see where this is going, and I already feel the pain.
But the pain gets more interesting in a way that you might not expect.
Oh, God.
He starts to bowl his, you know, ultimate, penultimate, or sure. anti-penultimate frame. And he is focused and concentrated. He's in the zone. He's going to get the one perfect game of his life.
This is amazing.
And as he brings the ball back and runs up, I go, "Hey!" And I yell.
You motherfucker.
Oh, God.
And it slides off and hits one pin.
Oh!
So it's not even a gutter ball. It's one pin.
Oh, my stomach.
And there are people who've been watching him because it's this perfect game. There's probably a huge crowd for bowling alley, which is what, 15 people?
Right. If that.
You know, an afternoon, rainy afternoon bowling, and they're all watching. And he is an athletic guy, and I'm a big guy. So they're ready for excitement. And he looks over at me, and I look at him, and we make eye contact. We're very good friends. And he walks over to me, and he stands in front of me. And as he walks over me and stands in front of me, I do something that everybody in the room thinks is odd, except for my friend. I put my hands behind my back, and I just hold my wrist behind my back, and I just stand there.
Mm-hmm.
And he reaches down, I'm wearing shorts at the time, and he grabs me by my balls. And he squeezes my balls and then takes his fist and hits me as hard as he can right in the solar plexus. He just goes, and I go, with my hands behind my back, I go completely unconscious.
Oh, my God.
You know, because I've just been, had my balls grabbed and been punched right in the stomach. So I go completely unconscious, and I crumble in his hands as he holds my balls. And I go completely out. And I don't know how long I'm out. They told me I was out. Not long. 5 seconds, 6 seconds, 10 seconds. I'm crumbled on the floor. I get up. I go, "Ah." He goes, "Ah." And we go back over, have a snack. And he has worked with me since the 70s. He is in my employ. He is on my crew, and we have never talked about it.
Wow.
We've never said a word about it. I never said I'm sorry. I never said, "Well, did you feel like we came out even?" It was just this, it was just probably the definition of what it's like to love an asshole. You know, he knows he's an asshole. He's not going to fight me. He's not going to defend himself. I have to decide what I feel this moment was worth.
Was it worth it
for me?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Now, come on. Now, you can't tell me that and you aren't, but I think anyone else would have to agree, that moment made your friendship stronger than if he had bowled the perfect game, which you wouldn't have given a shit about.
What's the idea of squeezing the balls
that's a weird
and
move.
Punching in the stomach? That's like how black holes form.
That must have looked like a choreographed, your hands go behind your back, his hands come out, and hit, you go
moment,
down.
And Penn knew what was about to happen as he reached his hands behind his back.
I've never hit anyone in my life in anger. Mm-hmm. I'm a pacifist to the world. So there was no chance that there was going to be a fight.
Mm-hmm.
He knew that about me. So he knew that he would decide how much he was going to hurt me and that I had already done the damage I was going to do. That whatever he did, I mean, imagine that situation. Whatever you do to someone, there will be no retaliation. So the morality of this story is only on him. I mean, he could have punched me in the face and broken my nose.
Sure.
Right? He could have picked up a ball and thrown it into my head and come close to killing me. But his idea was, what did this feel like to me to see that ball?
Just you know what I mean? The physical manifestation of what he was feeling emotionally.
Yeah. Yeah. I like the combo, too. I like the idea that he was like, he's walking up to you, he's like, "Just a punch in the stomach? No.
Better
just
a
tug
balls.
On the balls? No."
But I really love Penn's reaction where it's just, "Hey! All right, I see all the paperwork is in order." Like, he knew that there was going to be an emotional cost. There was going to be a cost. There was going to be a payment to be made.
All that.
Everything's been signed.
He's fully willing to pay
for that. We're now going to, I'll get whatever. And I didn't know what it was going to be. You know, I didn't know. I think if you'd asked me right then in that frozen moment, I would probably have said, I'm going to get punched in the face really hard.
Right.
You know what I mean? I'm going to get punched in the face harder than I've ever been punched. And it ended up that wasn't his choice.
I got to respect that, because if you were truly an asshole, what would have happened is you would have done that and then run away.
Running away.
The fact is, you did it. You knew there was going to be, and you wanted there to be a balanced and fair trade.
But to not toot my own horn too much, he would have found me. There was no place I was
going to
be
able to.
I mean, we cut to 8 years later in Mongolia, where I'm living in a hut, and he walks in. I knew this day would come. I didn't wait for this day.
Old friend.
He's living in that apartment building I built in Montana.
Like fucking Ra's al Ghul.
All the farm animals run away, and my new bride goes over. No.
Birds start falling from the sky.
Takes the baby.
Daddy, who is that?
This is an American thing. You could not understand it. It has to do with bowling.
There's a record scratch, but no record player. So no. I watched your Revision 3 show. Uh-huh. And you told this the chimp and the little person story as a reaction to it was because of Adam Savage. But I'm the one who told Adam Savage on this very podcast, and then that's why he reached out to you.
I was so
excited I couldn't even tell you to hear the story from your mouth about the relationship of chimpanzees and little people.
I thought you were circus.
I'm so sorry.
No, that's what they said to me.
No, that's what they said to you. I thought you were circus. Because you thought you knew.
But I didn't know that. It was an astonishing thing, and I've talked to people who are circus, but the strange thing is everyone in circus knows this, but primate people don't. I guess they don't have a lot of little people around.
Right.
So they don't notice. But
circus people have both.
Yeah,
both. And it was, I thought of this story when I saw The Rise of the Planet of the Apes.
Mm-hmm.
Because when they do the computer cartoon,
mm-hmm,
of the monkey, and I know it's a chimpanzee. I prefer the word monkey.
Yeah, yeah. They are very offended by when you're called a monkey.
Right, but they're monkeys. that thing. And the first time that I was there, and the I'll just tell very briefly what happened. I have parties at my house, and some of the parties are covered in the book, like when I had a very fat, naked Elvis urinating on people while singing Love Me Tender.
Was that the fat Elvis that performs at the Barbary Coast?
No.
Okay.
This is, a guy called Extreme Elvis.
Extreme Elvis.
You know Extreme
Elvis. I know Extreme Elvis. And it's like G.G. Allen and Elvis put together.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
Performance artist, but he can't get booked anywhere. He gets arrested. So, you know, he can only play private parties, and what asshole would have him at a private party?
That asshole.
And he came out, and he was, you know, urinating on my guests while singing Love Me Tender, and then we had an atheist baptism. It was a beautiful... And remember, all of this, and this is all that makes it good, is all done stone cold sober.
Sure.
I've never had a drink of alcohol in my life, never any recreational drug. So when I have a wild party with a piss and Elvis, it's all sober people. But another party I had was going to be my girlfriend at the time really thought that chimps were very, very cute. So I had a friend who had a chimp. And I was going to have a chimp over and then a lot of friends over for kind of a swimming barbecue party. And my friend Arturo, who was a little person, not particularly small, but certainly under probably about 3.5 feet.
Mm-hmm. Wait, Arturo, what's his last name?
Figueroa.
Yeah, I've worked with that guy.
Okay.
Yeah, Solve the Mole Man.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Arturo, wonderful man.
Yeah,
he's
great. He's an awesome guy.
Originally Mexican. And well, he is. That's part of the story. So I'm going to have this party. I hadn't seen Arturo in a while. He comes to our show, and afterwards he says, I said, hey, Arturo, we're having a party at my house tomorrow. You want to come by? Oh, yeah, man, I love to, man. Great. Okay, good, he's coming by. And then after he leaves, my friend Michael Goudeau, who is my co-host on the radio show and also the writer on Penn and Teller Tell a Lie, Goudeau says, did you just invite a little person and a monkey to the same party? And I said, yeah. And he said, I thought you were circus, man. I said, well, what do you mean? He goes, didn't you work circus? I said, yeah. He goes, you can't put a little person anywhere near a chimpanzee. They rip them apart. It's a dominance thing. I said, oh, what do I do? He said, well, you call them. I said, call who? He said, call either the monkey or Arturo. You know, one of them can't come to the party. And I go, oh, I'll call Arturo. So I call Arturo, and I have one of the most uncomfortable conversations of my life. Because I go, hey, Arturo, hey, man, what's up? I'm talking about the party tomorrow. Oh, yeah, man, I'm looking forward to it, man. Can I bring, you know, my cousins in town? Can she come by with me? Yeah. One problem. We have some people coming to. Yeah, man, what's up? Well, there might be a problem. Hey, I got no problems with anybody, man. Talk to anybody. You know, most little people, you know, they're assholes. They can be fucking assholes. But I'm cool with everybody, man. I get along with everybody. Talk to anybody, man. I'm cool. I said, I know you're cool, Arturo, and I love you. We're bringing an animal trainer to this. Oh, great, man. You know, when I worked in the Ringling Show, man, I worked with elephants. I worked with cats, man. What does he work with? Not elephants and not cats. What does he work with, man? He has a chimpanzee. What the fuck is wrong with you, man? He will rip me apart. He will rip me apart. He will kill me. He will. I can't be around them. They will kill me. Yeah, I know. What are you saying, man? I'm saying we're going to have to be really careful when you come to the party.
And then act three of the sitcom when we return from it.
Yeah. So Godot is there and Arturo is there and the monkey has not arrived. And Michael Godot, who's a practical man, a science man, says to me, we are going to put a chimpanzee and a little person in close proximity. And he said, we don't really know what's going to happen, but it's not going to be good. We need to take kitchen knives. Jesus. And if it gets out of hand, you have to look me in the eye and tell me you are willing to stab a chimpanzee to death to save a human being.
Oh, my God.
He said, we're getting the five biggest guys. We're going to stand there, and we will be holding knives. And if we cannot subdue the chimpanzee in any other way, we will need to kill it. And I go, okay.
It's a party, isn't it?
And Arturo says, we're going to leave your pool open. I'm taking my phone and my wallet out of my pocket. Monkeys hate water more than they hate little people. So if something goes bad, I will run as fast as I can and jump in the pool and try to stop the monkey from coming in after.
Oh, my God.
I go, oh, okay.
Rather than just not come to the party.
Yeah.
It's a party at Penn Jillette.
I know,
Chris.
I know.
Something had gone very wrong in our social structure. I don't know what it is. You know, it's kind of mass insanity. We had decided.
I feel like it might have been you.
Coming.
You went wrong.
Yeah. I think that's a truth I have to face. Yeah. You're thinking you call the animal trainer and say you can't come.
That's what I mean. Yeah. You know. I understand that you didn't.
But wait, Matt. No. Chimp at a party.
Yeah, I know. It's pretty cool.
This is the chimp that changes his own diapers.
Seriously.
You can say to him, get me a Diet Coke, and he goes in and gets you a Diet Coke and not a Coke.
The only thing he can't do is not kill a little person.
No, never mind.
That's the only command he won't follow.
I have a lot of those similar traits.
Yeah.
Now, you have a problem here. We have a lot of problems.
Yeah, of course.
But one of the problems is that people don't seem to understand that certain things are innate. And I'm not going to get into any argument about sexism because I don't have an argument there. But the chimpanzee will also feel up women. Mm-hmm. They will try to finger women. Mm-hmm. And if a woman tells them what to do, they also react very negatively. The person that can tell them what to do is the biggest person in the room. To the chimpanzee, I am a silverback. And when I would say, stop that, he would stop immediately.
Wow.
If a woman said stop that, he would go.
Wow.
And they also, it's great. If you have a chance of being a chimp, take it. Because really attractive women at the party, the monkey would just reach down the shirt and just grab her tit.
They think it's adorable.
Oh, isn't that funny? I don't know. And if they grab the hand, try to stop him, then he gets mad. It's terrific. It's like a soccer team.
Wow.
And
like a soccer team.
like a Princeton soccer team.
And so we have Arturo. And the way my courtyard is set up, Arturo is there. And Arturo has got people around him. And we just kind of want the monkey to see Arturo, right? And we have knives in our hands. And it's like this kind of Lord of the Flies thing. We have taken a solemn oath that we will stab a chimp. And for someone who is as pacifistic as me, this is horrible. But to save a little person.
Ethical debates.
Ethical debates. Certainly if you had, what's his name, from PETA and Silver, what's his name? It doesn't matter.
I like the idea that there would be people at the party going, hey, those guys are taking the little person's side. I think we have to band together
to murder this
chimp.
And
then all of a sudden, there's two factions at the party, two gangs.
It could happen almost.
We need to get knives too.
So my girlfriend at the time, an attractive actor from L.A., is holding the chimp like it's her child. It's wearing a little diaper. She's kind of sweet talking the chimp, and the trainer is right there, and the trainer is bonded to the chimp. And my girlfriend is bonded and is holy, and it's cuddly, and it's sweet, and it's great. And now what happens here is that there's a dominance issue, that the reason the chimpanzee doesn't kill everybody, because they have more strength than someone my size, mm-hmm. even at 80 pounds, is because there's a dominance thing, and they're smaller and aren't going to be able to vibe and this kind of stuff. I'm talking about shit I don't really understand, but I mean, in a very broad strokes, that's what's happening. Of course, what's happening in those pods is really much more complicated, and as complicated as what happens in our social structures. But that having been said, he's afraid of us because we're big. And holding the monkey, she's standing there, and there's this tension in the room. And Arturo comes around the corner, okay? And he's never been in this kind of situation, because in circus they keep them separate. Right there, kind of comes around the corner, and that monkey does that, you know, exorcist, Rise of the Planet of the Apes thing. And my girlfriend, who has her arms around the monkey ape and is supporting him, he just goes, whoo, and all her strength is nothing to him.
Wow.
And the trainer reaches, and he's just gone, and he's on the ground, and Arturo goes whipping around the corner into the house, slams the door, and now they're looking at each other through the glass.
Oh, God.
And it's going,
But what if it just grabbed his balls and punched a solar plexus?
It would have been fine.
It would have torn off the balls.
And so then we're all holding our knives and flop sweating, and it's over. And Arturo was safe. And Arturo just walks away from the window. And the monkey can't see him anymore. And the monkey goes, and jumps up into my girlfriend's arm. And he's all back to lovey-dovey. Let me tweak your nipples a little bit.
Wow. Holy crap.
And then for the rest of the party, we did this thing with our cell phones where when Arturo was in the band room and the monkey wanted to go into the band room because we thought it'd be funny to get pictures of the monkey playing the drums. Banging on the bongos like a chimpanzee. You want that picture, don't you? And of course, I should say
ain't working.
No, that's the way they do it.
Yeah.
I also should add into this, and maybe a lot of people hate me for this, but also we gave the monkey a lot of cigarettes because there's nothing funnier than a smoking monkey.
Like like Krusty's monkey in The Simpsons.
Yeah. Mr. Teeny.
You see a smoking monkey, you laugh your ass off. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't smoke, but I smoke's there for the monkey.
Yeah.
And I know, it's bad.
For the monkey, I smoke a cigar.
Yeah.
It's bad for the monkey.
I never touched a drop of alcohol, but I gave a ton to the monkey.
Well, yeah. And believe me, if acid were an option, That would have been considered. So we want to bring the monkey in, and then you would take your cell phone, and you would call Godot and say, where's Arturo? And they would say, Arturo's in the band room. The guys have been playing some blues, and Arturo's playing a little harmonica. And I go, okay, can you wrap that up and get Arturo out by the pool? We want the monkey to play drums. Hey, Arturo, We're all having a good time here, but now you've got to leave because we think the monkey would be more fun than the little person.
Arturo was a buzzkill.
Did you have to say that Arturo was playing a little harmonica?
I didn't want to say that. I'm so glad you did. He played a little harmonica. They picked up a little guitar.
So the whole rest of the five-hour day is just rotating. You know, a monkey wants to go outside. Arturo needs to come in.
Yeah.
Arturo wants to go to the barbecue, get himself a hamburger. Let's bring the monkey
in. It's like and one of those puzzles with the missing block.
Yeah, exactly. It's actually taking the boat across the river with the goat, the little person, the monkey. And then the...
Which one do you...
Yeah. Take that across and the wives can't see each other. Exactly. Riddle. And then the other only interesting... Besides, and I kind of slid over this, and I want you all to realize how sexy it is. It is very sexy in public to have an animal who can do anything to other people. The idea, I mean, like right now, we were in mixed company and there were like 30 or 40 people around, and we had a monkey that could just hand job and feel up anybody. We would be having a better time.
Yeah, you know? I mean, there's no
That's
question.
All. It's just because they're reaching, you know, you got this, you know, friends, girlfriends there, you know, friend of mine, this woman I know that's really wicked smart, wicked powerful, wicked strong, just great, wonderful, great, terrific. She's out by my pool in a bikini and a monkey's feeling her up. I am harder than Chinese algebra. I mean, it's just boom, bang, boom, done. But then the monkey does this other thing, you know. You start thinking, he understands English, you can talk to him.
Yeah.
You say, get me a soda. You can say all this stuff. You can say, no, don't do this. But then he just does something that's just so cool that you wouldn't think of doing. I mean, even if you were friends with Johnny Knoxville, this wouldn't happen. Someone's putting on suntan lotion, and it's, you know, it's banana citrus suntan lotion, and the monkey goes over and just goes and drinks the whole thing. He just squirts suntan lotion into his mouth, and then the trainer is trying to rinse banana suntan lotion out of a chimp's mouth. Wow. And once again, it's a great party.
Wow.
But I'm glad I you know, that's the story.
A wonderful story.
Wow.
And I also love, and then just sort of building off that, something you said earlier, that you've never done any substances. No. I've been sober for 8 years, and I never did drugs, but I just drank a lot. And
I went with the bowling,
of course. Yeah,
I was gonna say that's why I go bowling.
Yeah, but what I love is that it just hearing you tell these stories and talk about, you know, and just from knowing what I know about you, your decision to not touch substances is very consistent with what it seems like your mission statement in life, which is having real, true experiences.
If there had been alcohol involved, we could not have mixed the monkey with the little person.
No. Right.
It would have been too dangerous. But five big sober men with knives can do science.
Yep. But also it makes all of your experiences
vivid.
They're very vivid.
True.
They're very vivid.
It makes
they're
them
very true. The parties I've had, and since I have young children, the parties have changed because of course child services.
Of course.
But I filled up huge pools with cornstarch. And we all know, if you're going to do a nerd thing, everybody knows about cornstarch.
That's awesome.
And we had naked wrestling in cornstarch with about 100 of my friends.
Wow.
And what I found is, you know, if you have friends that are porn stars, and I do, it's very hard to get them naked because they're used to being paid for that. But if you have friends that are like nuclear physicists, easy to get them. You know, a woman that's a rocket scientist will take off her clothes like that because she doesn't have to monetize.
In other words,
the value.
It ain't rocket science.
Exactly. So everybody's wrestling in the cornstarch, which is really cool. And we're all outside and we're all naked. There's naked cornstarch wrestling. And there's also a lot of subtext because some people were enjoying the cornstarch wrestling even more than the wrestling. And but I decided
stay on tap.
As the feature event, it was going to be Arturo and I wrestling nude.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and all of a sudden, a figure is popping in your head for how much you'd pay to see me wrestle a little person.
$78.
No, the number's higher than what I would have thought.
$78?
$150.
Whoa.
How much are you going to pay me to watch it?
Now, don't you play that game. You know the truth. You know the truth. Don't play that. Oh, I don't want to see a guy naked.
No, no,
you
I'd love to see a guy naked, but it wouldn't, the cherry on the top is getting money for it. But 155 including Ticketmaster fees.
Okay, yeah. So we're about $400 here. Do like that.
Yep.
But this is all free for my friends. And I wrestled Arturo. We were having a great time because we acted like although no one fell for it, we acted like it was just getting up in a grudge match. Mm-hmm. You know, I went up there to say something to my friends, and Arturo heckled me a little bit, and I was like, "You little bastard!" And we, you know, started screaming and trash talking, and then we jump in the pool, and the crowd goes crazy. But what happened was Arturo's arms weren't long enough to hold his face out of the cornstarch. I didn't know this when we jumped in. So we are jumping around, rolling around nude in cornstarch. And I decide it'll be funny if I just push him down into the cornstarch. So I push him down to the cornstarch, and I declare victory. Now, what I don't know is he can't pull himself out of the cornstarch.
Oh, shit.
And he can't push his arms down to push off the bottom, and he also can't breathe. So, he's down there for just a little bit too long, and then I go, and I'm in the position of, you know,
just like a little chicken
to
tender.
To pull a little person out of cornstarch who can't breathe.
What a rough go Arturo is at here at parties.
Well, that's just two of them. The one where I hired a guy to nail his cock to a board and pull a topless stripper across the stage, Arturo just enjoyed that. He was just a spectator. And Extreme Elvis pissing on the crowd, Arturo had the catbird seat. He didn't have urine on him. He had a fine time.
All right,
so some of the parties have gone very well
unscathed
for Arturo. Yeah. But when I pulled him out, what really broke my heart is that Arturo said to me, "You know, you saved my life. I couldn't have." And I said, "Well, yes, but after I'd pushed you,
after I'd cornstarch
and held you down." But he was very grateful that I didn't just let him. Now I want to see what that forensics report from the police officer would have been.
Yeah.
You know, Penja, we always knew. We always knew there was something not quite right about Penn.
Yeah.
And sure enough, he drowned a naked little person in cornstarch in his backyard while his sick friends cheered.
Yeah. I can explain. Actually, I guess I can't. Yeah. This is pretty much exactly what happened.
Famous last words, too. Also, I can explain.
The many ways that I've gotten in trouble, I've always wondered how my friends would react. Like, I have my garage has my bedroom right mm-hmm. above it. And I had...
So you could be like the Fonz.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I had a Bronco. I had a Bronco automobile
mm-hmm.
that was painted pink and said Pink Death on the side of it. And my plate said Atheist. And I pulled in. I was on the phone talking to somebody. And I guess it was an interesting conversation because I got out of the car and continue the conversation, and left the car running in the garage.
Shit.
Then I closed the garage door.
Oh, boy.
And I went upstairs, finished my conversation, and went to bed. So I had a full-tank Bronco running in my garage all night. And I woke up at like 5 in the morning coughing. And my nose filled up and unable to breathe. And I said to myself, boy, the... bedroom sure seems smoky. And I went out and I pissed and I took a drink of water and blew my nose, which was black and sooty, and then went back to bed. Because that's the kind of guy I am. Well, I guess I'm just getting a cold or something.
Yeah, you've never slept better.
And I slept very soundly and then woke up groggy and sick and feeling awful. I'm like, oh,
wow.
Coming out with the flu. This is horrible. I kind of, and I get out and I open the door to outside and all of a sudden I'm feeling a lot better. And there's smoke pouring out of my bedroom. And I go, man, this is weird. So I go, wait a minute. That smells like exhaust. And I go downstairs, and the door to the garage is so hot I can't touch it. And I have to get towels. When I open the door, all this smoke comes out, and I have to get towels to touch the car to be able to reach in and turn it off. It's been going for, you know, whatever it was.
Literally Pink Death.
10 hours.
Yeah.
And I'm coughing and miserable. But that's not the important part of the story. None of that matters. What matters is my friends, if that had happened, I'd stayed in bed another few hours. Although I've been told that the ventilation was good enough that I would never die. But let's just say I could have died in that situation. Then we have my friends talking. And there would be two schools of thought on this. One, Penn was suicidal, we didn't know it, and decided to kill himself by going to bed with the exhaust in. The other is, Penn loved life, but was so stupid. He went to bed with
which
his
one would you running. Rather have people remember?
And I've talked to friends of mine, and I said, which camp would you be in? And most of them have said, well, we've never seen you that depressed, but we have seen you stupid. So I wonder, you know, if you were doing the newscast and one of the things pops up and it says, you know, you do a little thing, Penn Jillette found dead in his house, the car was running, and he died of carbon dioxide poisoning, and then you're going to have a little discussion here. Where do you go? Where do you go with it?
I can't believe he was that bummed out.
You go with the bummed out. Yeah.
Atheist killed by devil-possessed car.
You going with stupid?
I'm going with accident.
Okay.
I'm going with Maximum Overdrive or Christine.
There you go.
The car.
That's what I was gonna say. So everyone's gonna be like, he said he didn't believe in it. Now
you
the Lord.
What? You know why? Because if you really wanted to kill yourself, you would have been in the car in the garage.
No, not except it's so much more comfortable in bed. Exactly.
I guess that's true.
Exactly.
He wanted to be surrounded by.
I know how to kill myself. Believe me.
I want to die in a hammock. I just want to die in a hammock.
Is that it?
he died the way he wanted to live, in his bed sniffing exhaust.
Well, we're pretty much at the end of our hour with you, but there's a couple things that I want to cover before we release you into the wild. Number one, I didn't even get to talk to you about juggling, and in college...
Are you a juggler?
Yes, but I'm
why
no
are we
good
passing anymore. Cubs? We
I don't know. I can do that. I was taught to juggle by Peter Scolari.
Oh, sure.
Who
I know Peter.
When I was in college, I worked at a country club he belonged to, and he got me into juggling. And what put me off juggling was that I could never maintain five. I could always get the first little flourish, and then it just went away.
Well, five is hard. Five is hard. And the other thing that's bothersome now is that because of the internet, jugglers have gotten so much better.
Yeah.
And that's something, you know, unintended consequences. I can't believe that because of the internet, and not because they learn how to do it, but because they know it's possible.
Right.
You've got 13-year-olds passing, you know, 12 clubs.
Right.
You know,
seven balls.
Yeah. Just, and if you look at Jason Garfield and the, you know, the his world juggling championships and stuff, you've now got, I was a very good juggler in the 70s, and now even at my peak, I wouldn't even be considered a piker for amateurs.
I went to juggling conventions when I was in college, and one guy that I was always, and this is going to be a very obvious statement if you're a juggler, but if anyone listening can find Michael Motion videos, M-O-S-C-H-E-N.
But you know about Michael Motion.
What?
Do you know who taught him to juggle?
No.
Me.
What?
Do you know where Michael Motion lived?
No.
Next to Michael Collins.
it's better than that. I grew up at 48 Place Terrace, Greenfield, Massachusetts, 01301. That's where I grew up. Greenfield, Massachusetts, 48 Place Terrace. Mike Motion grew up at 38 Place Terrace, Greenfield, Massachusetts, 01301.
This is amazing.
So, I grew up in Lowell.
Shut the fuck
Lowell?
Up. We're not talking.
Yeah. You're from Lowell?
Yeah, from Lowell.
Yeah, Kerouac.
All right, keep talking again.
Kerouac.
Kerouac is good.
You know Greenfield.
I know Greenfield. Yeah,
you know
where Greenfield is. Yeah,
I know Lowell. Well, Lowell and Greenfield, we're the same guy. We know all the same stuff.
We've seen crack.
Yeah. So when I was 12 years old, I desperately wanted to be in show business. Had never met anybody in show business. Didn't think it was possible. So one of the things I did was I learned to juggle. And Colin Motion, who was Mike Motion's older brother by year, and I got a book by Ken Benj from the library on how to juggle.
Wow.
And we learned to juggle with no help, you know, just from a book, learned to do a shower before we did a cascade. But we had lots of time to practice. We were in Greenfield, Massachusetts. And then the week after we started, Mike Motion joined in. And Mike Motion and I started juggling more and more and more and more. And all through high school, our group, the Toss-Ups, was Colin Motion, Mike Motion, and Penn Jillette. And our opening joke was, hi, we're the Toss-Ups. We used to be called the Throw-Ups, but we didn't get as much work. And we would juggle and pass. And then I got out of high school, did not graduate, but plea bargained, got out.
Mm-hmm.
And And I went to Ringling Brothers Barnum Bear, the greatest show on earth, Clown College. Then I got out in that and moved to New York and teamed up with Mike Motion. And we did a two-person juggling act. We were the first to pass nine clubs.
Holy shit.
We were really stupid good. And then we got a job at Great Adventure.
It all comes back around!
Where Mike Motion was standing watching the 300 game be ruined by his juggling partner.
No fucking way!
But it goes further than that.
This is like an Arrested Development episode.
We saw Arturo and the chimpanzee show up.
Well, it turned out that I bet Teller, you know, and I was talking to Teller, and I wanted to team up with Teller, but we still had this big place in Jersey. So Mike Motion lived in a house with me and Teller.
Oh my God. And he would
be practicing all the time, working on his solo act while I was working with Teller, and we'd still pass clubs all the time. And I went to Canal Street in New York City, and I was looking for anything that could put together a routine. Yeah. I wanted to do some juggling in the Asparagus Valley Cultural Society. I was already doing two juggling things, doing a ball act and a knife act. I wanted one more thing. So I went to Canal Street, and they had these clear crystal balls.
Yes.
Well, let me finish. A little bigger than softballs.
So excited.
And I bought these crystal balls. I bought five of them. And I brought them back to our house. And I sat with Teller and I sat by myself and I juggled these three, four, five balls in every combination I could, trying to find, because the crystal balls were beautiful. And they didn't look unbreakable. They looked powerful and nice. So I worked and worked and worked. And I was looking in the mirror and I was talking to Teller. I could not find a bit to go with those crystal balls. So they were there on the floor, these acrylic crystal balls.
Oh my God.
And Mike Motion comes to me and says, because we would always go into the Museum of Television History, which you don't, you know, you needed before the internet, and watch these kinescopes of variety acts. So Michael had watched this person that did some one ball manipulation. So Michael said to me, I'm thinking about monkeying with one ball. And I said, oh, that's good juggling because it's one less than you have hands. That'll kill. And they'll be able to focus on it. And Michael came to me and said, you know, could I take those crystal acrylic balls you bought and see if I can do a routine with those?
Oh my
and I said,
God.
I got nothing, man. Go ahead. And then 8 months later, Michael came to us with his one-ball juggling routine with the crystal balls that then went up to two and what is now called contact juggling, but at that time was called Mike Motion's fucking act because everybody stole it. And Mike Motion went on to become a genius MacArthur Grant juggler, and I went on to be in Penn and Teller. But from the time we were 5 years old, we were best friends. I mean, Mike Motion, Colin Motion, and Penn Jillette were the three Motion brothers. You know, we all went everywhere together.
So you've heard of them.
And yes, I was the first one to see his triangle routine.
Oh my God.
I was the first one to see the sticks thing.
Did he get to meet David Bowie in Labyrinth?
I did. He got to be his hands.
He was the hands.
Yeah, yeah. He's the hands for
him. And he also did the thing. He also did this thing in like a, I don't know what it was called, but it looked like if you sectioned out a pipe, a big pipe, and he would take balls and just in the middle of it, just bounce balls all around this circle. Yeah. But anyway, I'm so sorry that I didn't know that. That connection is amazing.
And
I bow to you.
If Mike Motion ever sits in this seat and you ask him that question, Mike Motion will say, Colin and I learned to juggle, then a week later we brought panic. He will also tell you, Penn and I went to Canal Street together, and we bought the balls and brought them back. We were both working on routines simultaneously, and Penn couldn't come up with anything, and I came up with something that changed juggling in the 20th century.
Yes.
Pretty much complete agreement. It has, at its core, Penn failed, Mike succeeded. But there are small details that are slightly different.
Well, you have let's just quickly plug the stuff that you have coming. Sure. You have your book that's out.
The book of 5 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list. God No, Signs You May Already Be an Atheist and Other Magical Tales. And the little person and the monkey are not in there, but the extreme Elvis, the whole atheist baptism with a urinating fat Elvis, and me, Ron Jeremy, and extreme Elvis lined up, because extreme Elvis has one of the smallest penises in the world, and of course Ron Jeremy we all know, and I stood stood between them, and we took a picture, which I like to call Trojans. We fit all men. And
like,
I also
like a seal pipe.
We have a show.
The Discovery Show, yeah.
On the Disco Channel,
yep.
Which I'm trying to call Disco Channel.
I support this.
The Discovery Channel, right after everybody's favorites, the Mythbusters, mm-hmm. who are opening for us.
Yep.
And yeah. On Wednesday night at 9 o'clock, you can watch the Mythbusters on the Disco Channel. And at 10 o'clock, you can watch Penn and Teller Tell a Lie, which is the same first three words as Penn and Teller Bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
We will give you 7 unbelievable science stories, and one of them is a big obese lie. And you watch it home with your little apps and your computers and try to see if you can vote for when Penn and Teller are lying and when we're telling you the truth about your universe.
Well, I appreciate that, and I wish you the best of luck with the show and the book. And also, just to tell you that that you guys were very influential to me as a comic in the 80s. I mean, I did have an appreciation of illusion and magic, but I was much more of a comedy nerd.
Mm-hmm.
And guys like you, and then also when I was growing up, I loved Amazing Jonathan. Like,
oh, sure.
Like just watching the guys who were truly able to pull comedy in a way that spoke to me and you know, revealed this world to me. So I thank you.
Well, thank you so much. And, you know, all this has really taught me is that I really, really should get together another party. And y'all should be yes. invited.
I think that's
we'll bring Mike Collins out.
I will drive
Holy
out there
shit.
For that.
Yeah.
I'll hit
All right.
Vegas for that.
Well, thank you so much, Penn Jillette. Enjoy your burrito, everyone. And thanks for listening.
Yeah.
That's the end. The end of the show.
Oh.
Hey, you piece of shit.
No, not
that's
you,
what
Chris.
It says. Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Although that was good right off the top of your
head. Thank you, yeah.
That was
yeah.
like wrinkles.
I was really reaching down. Hey, you there with the shirt.
Call me a hockey puck.
Hey, you with the shoes.
Oh, it's I have shoes. You? He's talking about me.
Those shoes are dumb.
Honey, isn't this great? He's talking about
we
me.
We paid $60 for this. Penn Jillette is
How's
back.
How's your steak?
Tell me about...
Is the show started?
Yeah.
It just happened just like that?
That was it, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's my magic.
It's very good.
Seamless,
very good.
Seamless transition.
Just one moment I was talking, and then the next moment I was talking.
Penn's podcast actually starts.
Welcome to the podcast.
There you go. That's good. Sure.
Nice.
You must have seen some legendary shows in Vegas.
Really?
Right? Have you not? Do you go see shows there?
I went to see, when I first came to Vegas, you know, the big shift in Vegas, everybody talks about, you know, mob to corporate. And right. the best thing said to me about Vegas, which I loved, was when I first, I guess I was just visiting. I wasn't even working there, like in the 80s, way back. I get in a cab, and the cab driver was explaining to me what Vegas is. And he said, you know, Vegas used to be really classy, and then Elvis came and brought all the hicks with him.
Brought all the hicks with them. So it went from the sort of Bugsy Siegel.
Well, you know, the Rat Pack. Let's do it. Let's keep it all entertainment.
Yeah,
right.
It went from the Rat Pack to, you know, guys doing George Burns impersonations. You know?
Right, right.
And
I'm sorry, Danny Gans. Rest in peace.
Well, you know, I had a discussion with a writer in Vegas. We're having this big discussion, and we're arguing over the worst show in Vegas.
Uh-huh.
And he was contending Danny Gans,
yeah,
and I was contending another show, which I will not mention.
Okay.
And we were talking about, you know, how you weigh art, the criteria for art. And what I weigh all art by is the balance, or actually the cumulative of skill and crazy.
Mm-hmm.
You want 100% skill and 100% crazy.
Okay.
Or say that any way you want. You know, you want skill and you want passion.
Right.
But any way you want to break it down. So you have a handful of people at any given time who have tremendous skill and tremendous passion. Bob Dylan, Miles Davis, Picasso, Stravinsky. Aren't a lot of them, right?
Right.
You can, you know, and I said in our lifetime that I named mostly people who were dead.
Right.
But Bob Dylan okay. is alive. And when you go see Bob Dylan, at the end of the show, what you want to do is write a play, you want to put out an album, you want to write poetry, you want to do everything, because he's so good, he inspires you. He makes you think you're good, too. He makes you think life is good. And then there are the people that are really, really skilled but lack passion. And
right.
You go, well, that's okay. They're a little cynical. They do the same stuff all the time. But, boy, they practiced a lot, you know? And they're really good. You know, and I made the guitar gesture because I don't want to mention Eddie Van Halen.
Sure.
But, you know, they're really, really good, but they're not crazy. There's not this. Then you have the people that are just crazy.
Yeah.
And have no skill at all. David Allan Coe.
Okay.
You ever see the country guy, David Allan Coe?
I've heard of him, yeah.
Crazier than a shithouse rat, no skills, I'll go anywhere to see him.
Okay.
He's that good a performer. And then you have people that are varying degrees of that kind of stuff.
Right.
When you go to a show, you're trying to see passion and skill just fully blown out there. What you never see is a complete lack of skill and a complete lack of passion. Someone who's cynical and can't do anything. It's very, very rare. Because people that have no skill and still get on stage should have some passion for performing
to
the audience.
That's what internet comment threads are for.
People exactly, exactly, exactly. So there is an act in Vegas, that the name of which I will not say, but the description has already made it clear, that is someone who lacks all skill and lacks all passion.
Okay.
Comes out sneering and contemptuous of his audience and of himself, and can't do anything.
Okay.
And has a long run in Vegas. Then there's Danny Gans, who is also condescending, contemptuous, and no skill.
Also only famous in Las Vegas.
Yeah, exactly.
My dad, though, loved him. We went in the 90s.
Did you get a bowling joke?
Well, did he have a bowling joke? He was my dad.
It was something how you pick up a hooker with three fingers, something like that.
Something like that, yeah. I think it was, you know, my dad represent. I love him to death, but his sort of artistic appreciation sensibilities are mainstream America.
Your dad is America.
He is America. And so, you know, like in the 90s, he was like, I mean, like, my dad was the guy that said I should watch blue-collar comedy because I would love it because I'm from the South. He also wanted me to see Danny Gans. He was like, this guy, he sings, he dances, he does impressions, he does it all.
What bothers me, the list of things that bothered me about Danny Gans, and what I think is...
I always hated it. I just want to go on the record as I... It's, genuinely disliked him. I don't know why.
I don't know him. Never met him personally.
It's very good to speak ill of the dead because they won't mess with you.
Yeah, they're not going to fuck with me.
We're safe. He would do... Now, when you see Gilbert Gottfried, who is the best of us, you know, he's the funniest man alive and absolute genius.
Mm-hmm.
When you see Gilbert, he does an impression. There's something he brings to the impression, besides doing them dead on and perfectly accurate.
Right.
He'll give you Groucho and the year of Groucho.
Yes,
you
know? He does.
He will do 56, 57, 58
Groucho. Here's my 72 Groucho.
Yeah, he'll do all of them. He'll do all, and he does them all perfectly. He always brings something conceptual to the impersonation. It's not just, I broke down in Hollywood, and who comes to help me? Oh, it's Jack Nicholson.
Right.
Hey, here's Johnny.
Right.
You know, not one of those things. He actually brings something. He does brilliant stuff, like, you know, Bob Dylan and Floyd the Barber from Mayberry RFD.
All right.
Doing Who's On First.
Okay.
There you get a lot.
That's,
you know,
a concept.
And you've got, he'll do George and Ringo doing Who's On First. He'll do Jerry Lewis with, you know, always bring something to it. Danny Gans would do pieces of the person's act that he was doing an impersonation of. So it was actually part of George Burns' act that he would just do. It was almost like it was a mashup, but with less artistic. So we're arguing. And he's saying that Danny Gans, we're talking about this art thing.
Sure.
That what you're going for perfect art, is 100% passion, crazy, bravery, and 100% skill.
Mm-hmm.
And then we were saying, for the other side of that, for the worst act possible, you want cynicism, contempt, coupled with not able to do anything. And he brought up Danny Gans. And I said, yes, yes, yes. Danny Gans was awful. And homophobic and sexist and unpleasant racial stuff, and had no skill. But my guy is worse,
right?
And we spent we were at what's that place? Capriotti's, where they have the big pastrami sandwiches.
Okay,
and through a whole big pastrami sandwich, we argued about this, and then he called me at 9 the next morning and said, "You win. Your act is the worst in Vegas." And I said, "What happened?" He said, "Danny Gans died last night." Oh, I said, "Last night?" He said, "Yes." So now you win hands down. We have no arguments. We're now the best of friends. And this is what's so great about this. There's a great punchline to this. At the time, he was in a relationship having sex with a woman who acts in pornographic films. Mm-hmm. That was their. He was a writer in Vegas, and he was with this woman. And their breakup was happening because he was and is an atheist.
Okay. Mm.
And she was spiritual.
Okay.
So you can chart, you can actually draw this out on a graph. You can start when you are sleeping with a pornographic actress and you are having sex with her. How long before spirituality is a topic of discussion? you can draw that graph, right? Because there are 10 sex acts that if you're a writer in Vegas, you've never done.
Sure.
That she does on a daily basis.
Right.
So you do one of those, you figure he's 30 years old, maybe twice a day, okay?
Right.
You know, under 30, you have sex as often as you eat, mm-hmm. but it tapers off from there.
Sure.
So you got 10 sex acts he wants to do, you know? You know, you want to go down there. You know, the one that doesn't mean automatic teller machine. Mm. You want to do all of those. You just want to go boom.
Did you just make an ass to mouth reference?
Yeah. Well, see, whenever anybody says to me ATM machine,
yeah.
No, they say ATM machine. I say, well, you must mean ass to mouth machine because ATM automatic teller has the word machine.
Just like when people say PIN number.
Yeah, and you're certainly not stupid enough to say machine.
Right.
So there must be a machine somewhere that does ass to mouth.
I made that joke on Twitter when I went to the Adult Entertainment Expo once. It was going on at the same time as CES, and I was like, I think the ATM machine here means something different.
Exactly.
And no one got what I was talking about.
Well, I'm glad. So you explained it. It helped.
Yes.
So you got twice a day. So after 5 days, then the window is open to talk with her about spirituality.
Sure.
But I think you can do those 10 things again.
Right.
So it's really 10, 15, maybe a month you go before you go, okay, we've done all of that. Now what do you think about God?
I mean, exactly. When you finish your act, you're toweling off some light poop off of your genitals, and you're like, well, so let's talk about
Santorum.
Let's
you're cleaning up the Santorum. Isn't that what we're supposed to be doing?
That's the euphemism now. Then you can say, so what do you think about God?
Yeah, exactly.
Like that,
exactly.
That's the time when that comes
so,
up.
So he had gotten to that point with her, and they were having real serious arguments, really horrible arguments about this. And he was using, and this is just a warning to listeners, don't ever use me as an example in any argument with someone you love. Don't say the words Penn or Jillette or a big fat guy from Penn & Teller. Don't use anything that could mean me.
Any reference
when you're talking to someone that you love or trying to love. Just a little piece of advice. Because once you bring up, well, you know, Penn says it's over for you.
Right.
You've lost the argument right away. But he's brought up, you know, Penn says this, this, and this about skepticism. And they're arguing not only God, but also skeptic stuff.
Okay? Sure.
She believes in ESP and all the other things you have to believe in to do milk enemas. Sure. Right? She has, you know, she has that whole list of things that she believes in. And
I sensed you were going to spray milk into me.
Yeah. And she then, as her final, you know, QED slam, whatever the children say, for the win, she comes in with, see, you and Penn knew Danny Gans was going to die.
Oh, my.
That's why you had that discussion. That's why Penn said that if one of them goes away, we'll agree completely, because you knew it. And that was her argument, not grasping at straws argument, but that was the argument of, so, see? You know, that was her, you know, that was her Pascal's wager. You know?
I would like to see it more that you're psychokinetic, and when you finish a pastrami sandwich while you're talking about someone, that person dies.
Or when I can put out enough hate towards someone, they just die. But if that's true, there's a lot of people living we have to explain.
There's a lot of pastrami.
So, in the 80s, people went to Vegas ironically.
Yes.
Everybody went ironically. You would go there. If you didn't smoke cigars, you'd smoke cigars. You know, yeah. If you didn't have brandy, you'd drink brandy. You did all the stuff you didn't do. You wore a skinny tie. You know, you walked around and you went to shows that were not good and you experienced the show ironically, which is fun.
Yeah.
And then you left. And that's why, you know, we came in the early 90s and Blue Man Group and stuff and had to train people that maybe you can actually see a show that you don't have to watch ironically, that you can actually enjoy. So I went
It's like the internet.
What's that?
It's exactly like the internet. People like watch a lot of stuff ironically, and you train people to actually see good things in Vegas.
Yeah,
but so it's possible.
You have to do that. You have to do that. So I went, it was in the 80s, and I guess I was on Broadway. And I went out to Vegas with some, you know, goofball friends of mine. I had a couple days off. Went to Vegas. We wanted to go to the Grand Canyon and do that kind of stuff, you know. And I'm fully, even though it's the 80s, I'm fully Ramones. You know, I got a black leather jacket, and I got a T-shirt, and I got sunglasses. And we decide to see, as a gag, ironically, we're going to go and laugh at Dean Martin.
Okay.
So like 1989, 88. You know, me and a couple of my douchebag friends are going to go see Dean Martin. And we got, you know, because at that point, I'm on Broadway. So, you know, we have a VIP booth, right?
Okay.
And I'm there with, you know, whatever it was, William Morris, ICM or something. Mm. And they got everything picked up. And, you know, I tipped the maitre d' $100 and I'm a star and shit. And we sit in the banquette. And our plan is not to do anything rude. I want to make that very clear. Never to heckle, never to scoff. Yeah. Never to do anything, but in my heart, you know, which we know because we talked about it beforehand, no one in the audience knows. We keep that secret. But we are intending to witness Dean Martin ironically.
Sure.
We intend to kind of go, yeah, Rat Pack, right? Now it's in the 80s. This would be great. And Dean Martin came out and kicked my ass harder than it's ever been kicked.
Really?
It was a perfect show. And it was such... It was exactly the Ramones. I use the Ramones example because when you go see the Ramones, and you probably are too young, you didn't see the Ramones.
I did not see the Ramones, no.
But for those of us who are elderly, you know, we saw the Ramones I saw the Ramones in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s. I saw them many, many times. And you'd take someone to see the Ramones, especially in the early days, you know, when I was, you know, their age, you know. I guess I would still be, except they stopped counting after they're dead. Right. It doesn't matter. We're around the same age, sure, as the Ramones. And you'd go to like CBGB in 76 to see the Ramones. And you'd bring someone with you, right? Someone that like knew a little bit about music. And four songs in, the person would either say out loud or say to himself or herself, they're not really going to do another song at that tempo in G without a guitar solo, with the same lyrics we don't quite understand. And you'd kind of go, yeah, they are. And then they would do four more of those, and it would hit like 35 minutes of, oh, no, they are, and the same chords. And just, at 10 minutes, 15 minutes, it was completely and utterly indecipherable as art. It was an insane experience. What am I doing here? You know, it's not the angst of the Sex Pistols. There's not this kind of poetry. It's not, you know, the genius of the Clash, the wittiness of Elvis Costello. These are stupid guys doing stupid things, right? And which incidentally, Jersey Boys is such a huge success. I've often thought if you wanted to do a musical about people stupider than the Four Seasons, you have to go to the Ramones. And that's the only way you can dumb it down more. So you say, which they weren't actually stupid, but the show was stupid, right?
Okay.
And then at about 35 minutes, everybody understood it. And then you were like, of course they're going to do another song at that tempo in G. Of course it's going to be indecipherable. And this is the greatest thing I've ever seen. There was a purity to it that won. You know, if you're a half-assed artist, then what you want to do is do a lot of variation. Ah, you know, let's do a slow number. Let's do an acoustic number. Let's change guitars 20 times. You know, let's be Edge. And every single guitar solo will have a different guitar.
Okay.
It'll be plugged into a different. No. The Ramones just, what are they about? Over and over again. And Dean Martin was precisely that. You would say to yourself, he's not really going to be that relaxed, that comfortable, and do half a song and then just trail off for no reason. He can't really seem like a pleasant uncle with us in his living room and just loving him for this long. He's got to change it up. And it was exactly the Ramones. Because in 15 minutes, you just go, he's not going to go, everybody, screw it. He's not going to do that again. He can't do that again. And he does it 15 more times. And I want to tell you, and we were just destroyed. And I'm looking over at these guys with me who are there to be there ironically. And I see them just, and if you've ever done that, if you've ever gone to a show in order to ridicule someone in your heart, and then they do the best show you've ever seen, it's a very, very special experience. It's not something you get. It's not like, you know, someone you thought was an idiot and then you end up really liking them over lunch. It's much more powerful than that.
Because it widens your scope. It widens your understanding.
You're a different person.
Yes.
You become a different person, you know, and you just kind of go, oh, so Tony Orlando and Don can be good. Okay, that's a bad example. But you know what I'm saying. It just blows us up. And I'm going to do some timing that Dean Martin did.
Okay.
And this is, as far as I remember, without exaggeration, this is the actual timing Dean Martin did. The actual timing. Now, at the time, Shirley MacLaine was talking a lot about spiritualism and stuff like that. And, of course, Dean Martin had been in some movies with Shirley MacLaine, you know, Warren Beatty's brother, part of the whole Hollywood thing. Now, this is the timing that Dean Martin does on what, in his show, passes for a joke. You could never get away with it. No one else in the world can. But he brought down the house with this. He went, I know Shirley MacLaine. I know her personally. She's a nut. Okay, and that timing, this incredible, you're in a Vegas lounge with 1,100 people that all have glasses, and it's dead quiet, and Dean's doing nothing except searching for the word nut. And then he stops halfway through the show and goes, you know, you can't possibly see this, but from where I'm standing, a spotlight looks just like a train coming at me from the sky, like it's going to run me over. You can't see that, can you? But it looks just like a train coming at me from the sky.
Did he know what he was doing?
Yes, yes, yes. And on top of that, and this is important to know about the world, I believe Dean Martin was a sociopath. Oh. I believe Dean Martin had no empathy for other people whatsoever. He did not feel empathy. That doesn't mean he wasn't a good person. It doesn't mean he couldn't even love, but just not empathy. You know the test they do for a sociopath where you bang your hand and everybody who's not will go, ooh, you know. But a sociopath may get you medical attention. They may help you. They may show you sympathy. But that moment that your hand gets hit with a hammer, they don't cringe.
Oh, okay? Wow. Because they have they can't be empathic.
They're not instant thing. Someone gets hit by a truck, they'll run and get help, but they won't go, whoa! They don't do that, you know. They just go, okay, I'll get help.
That'd be amazing if Dean Martin was a serial killer, a la Dexter.
No, but you don't. See, if you have a doctor or a lawyer, try to find a sociopath. You do not want someone who feels empathy for you while they're taking out your liver.
This is true.
You want someone who's following the actual rule. You're endoscopic, we're going to do this. They don't go, you don't want anybody doing that.
It's gross, you guys.
It's really gross.
So, well, it's fascinating to me that a performer could not have empathy.
Oh, well, that's the great thing. Because the other thing is, if you think, and I'm not going to have you do this out loud because it might be embarrassing, but I want you to think about the sexiest person you ever encountered. Don't say someone you had sex with that was wonderful, but the person that you looked at them and talked to them a little bit and just completely melted.
Sure.
That is a sociopath. Because we have such eagerness to please them. The fact that they don't have that there's a kind of sexiness that just demands from you that you show me that you're worthy of me looking at you.
Is that what people refer to as like magnetism?
I believe it is. I believe that that is, you know, and you wouldn't want to say this publicly or on a podcast or anything.
Sure.
But I believe that what we find attractive, magnetism and so on, is simply sociopathology. There's nothing else. Because Dean Martin, I mean this, the Sex Pistols, okay? Come out on stage and they spit on you and they don't care and they throw beer at you and it's just completely transparent. All they want is your love.
Right.
You know, that's all they want. And no one believes them for a second. Not one of their fans believes that they really hate their audience.
Right.
They adore their audience.
Because why would they fucking be there if they really hated them?
Well, that's the answer with Dean Martin. He doesn't need you at all. And it's an amazing feeling to sit in an audience with someone on stage who is in no way needy.
Right.
You know, in no way desperate. And Bob Dylan is needy. You know, the greatest performers you can think of are needy. Dean Martin was not. And there was a moment during his show when someone said something fairly loud. I don't think you'd call it a heckle, but they were talking at a table while he was talking fairly loudly. And Dean looks over at him and they stop instantly. And Dean's reaction to this heckle, you know, was not, hey, I don't go down to the bus station, knock the dick out of your mouth when you're sure. working. You know, none of that, you know, ooh, when second cousins marry, none of that stuff, you know. He just, or I remember my first beer, none of that.
Right.
He just looks over at him for a moment and they shut up. And when, as soon as they shut up, he goes, no, you don't have to be quiet. You know, Sinatra, Frank Sinatra. You got to be quiet when he's working. You got to pay attention. But you know, you can bowl during my act. And I the bowling was not put for you. That's what he says.
Maybe he put it for me.
Maybe he did.
He ask about me? I want him to like me so bad.
It's exactly that. So your question that you started here just moments ago.
Yes.
Moments.
Was what great shows have you seen in Vegas?
And Dean Martin.
The answer was Dean Martin.
I love that idea.
One of the greatest shows I've ever seen in my life.
I love that idea. And you're absolutely right. Like, there are certain performers where you go, oh, they just have a thing. And now that you've put that into words, in my head, I'm piecing together, oh, yeah, none of those performers made it seem like they needed me to like them. That's so fucking crazy. Where I feel like when I'm on stage, I'm just constantly like, hey, please like me.
Love me.
Please like me.
Love me. I'm up here
because I need you to like me.
Yeah.
So why even perform? Was it just because it was his profession and he didn't know what else to do?
I think there's a one-word answer.
Mm.
Pussy.
Pussy.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the only answer possible for Dean Martin. You know, there's a book. Nick Toshis wrote a book called Dino. That's Dean Martin's life story.
Yeah.
And it is full of amazing, amazing piece of information. When Jerry, you know, and people don't know this, and they shouldn't, I guess, but it still bothers me. The most successful entertainment act by any metric you want to use in the United States of America's history was Martin and Lewis. No comparison with Sinatra, no comparison with the Beatles, no comparison with Elvis.
Wow.
For 18 months, in the mid-50s, they would stop all traffic in Times Square if they walked out of their hotel room. They were huge, huge superstars. And you can't even understand the level that they were stars. For long term, for percentage of the country, it's Bing Crosby, you know. For iconography, you know, it's Elvis, you know. And, of course, for record sales, it's Justin Bieber. I mean,
right.
that just ends up with population. But really, for a certain way you want to measure it, which is, you know, stopping traffic, changing the world, every single radio show, every single newspaper article mentioning them, it's Martin and Lewis right there in that sweet spot. And then they broke up. And Jerry Lewis called Dean Martin after they broke up and said, there was going to be this little moment of closure afterwards. And Jerry Lewis said, you know, Dean, a lot of guys can sing like you. They can be funny. A lot of guys can do all the stuff we do. But there's something about the two of us together that really grabbed America. And I think, you know, thinking about it, Dean, I think that something was love. I think people just felt this love between us. They just felt this love. And Dean said, "You can call it love if you want. I just saw a big fucking dollar sign. Goodbye."
Oh my god.
That's it. You know.
That is insane.
Yeah. And what you had with Martin and Lewis, and if you watch any of the stuff with them, you have this combination of someone who cares so desperately as Arthur Penn, who directed Martin and Lewis and was a friend of mine, one of the greatest American directors of all time. I don't know why I said American in there. It was like to try to pretend that I knew something about anything that wasn't American.
What if you had said, I'd be like, is that guy from Russia? No.
You're American. I'm an American. Okay. Arthur Penn, one of the greatest directors of all time, who worked with Martin Lewis, said, you know, when you were in a room, Jerry Lewis used up all the air in the room.
Right.
You couldn't breathe when you were in a room with him because he sucked up everything. So, I mean, no one has ever wanted approval more than Jerry Lewis, and no one has ever wanted it less than Dean Martin. And you put these two guys on stage, and the psyche of watching them, you just blow up. You don't know what to do.
They're polarized.
Yeah, exactly. It's this beautiful thing. So, yeah, going to see Dean Martin, ironically, in Vegas, huge mistake for me. Because I should have gone in, I mean, on my knees, crawling and bowing. It still is. And I've seen a lot of shows. I've seen a lot of really good people. You know, I have seen Sinatra. I have seen the Sex Pistols. You know, I have seen The Clash. I've seen, you know, I haven't seen the Beatles. But, you know, I've seen Dylan a lot. I've seen some good acts. And Dean Martin is probably the top.
And it was probably just him on stage with a microphone.
Yeah. Well, you know, in a band. Yeah.
Maybe he and Martin were like the two halves of the Dark Crystal, and someone just needed to reunite the shard with the crystal so they would morph into that one. Because it sounds like they were just perfectly balanced opposites.
And you know, when you're on stage, and I'm sure you felt this, there are moments when you're on stage that you've got a bit that's actually good,
mm-hmm.
and you've worked on it a little bit, and does kind of work, and you do kind of have confidence, and you start going into that, and for a split second, the only thing going through your head is something other than love me, love me, love me, love me.
Yeah.
And you feel that moment, and you go, wow, you know, they don't really need me to beg them to love me. They really just need me to be good.
Well, it
and that doesn't cross your mind until very late in show business.
Did that change the way, because you were on Broadway, and then you went back to do your show, did it? Do you feel like that changed you on as a performer at all?
Oh yeah. I also it gives you a chance to you can for a moment tune out the audience and just try to do really good stuff. It's the hardest thing in the world to do because if you look at stand-up acts, it's a little laugh every 20 seconds, big laugh every minute and a half.
Mm-hmm.
And unless you're hitting that rhythm, you know, which is the rhythm kind of created out of vaudeville and burlesque, things feel really, really wrong. And you start panicking. And yet, when you listen to the people you care about the most, Lenny Bruce, you know, George Carlin, all those people don't follow that rule.
Louis doesn't follow.
No,
that
not at all. Oh, no. Louis's probably, and I, you know, Lenny Bruce and George Carlin, my biggest heroes in the world. If I had more distance and wasn't the age I am, Louis C.K. is probably better.
Yeah.
You know, certainly. You know, and I bet he would say because of building on their shoulders, but maybe even not even counting that. His stuff is so intellectually interesting. And his stuff is so completely committed and completely beautiful. I don't think you're going to find better than Louis C.K.
Yeah.
That's a perfect example of that. That he just doesn't feel like, you know, he hasn't gotten a laugh in a minute. And that's okay.
Yeah.
You know, it's a great.
Because you're still interested in hearing what he's saying and you still, yeah. like the, yeah, he, even before he kind of hit this stride, he always had an insane way of kind of spinning your perspective on a topic and making you go, oh, fuck, how did you get that out of that?
Yeah, he's just so wicked good. And really, his thing about technology that he did on, was it Letterman?
Or Conan, I think.
Conan, yeah.
Where it's like, we didn't have this tech, like about on the planes and the Wi-Fi, yeah.
Is one, I mean, it is the argument that every pro-science person has tried to make in, you know, hour-long lectures. And he does it in, 3 minutes a couch. And it's perfect. It's just a perfect intellectual argument that's also really funny.
Why is it then that we're comedy, we're really like really really good comedy? You know, it actually is compelling. It sort of talks about the zeitgeist of it, it makes good points, and yet I feel like people don't really take it serious. I mean, like, it sounds weird to say they don't take comedy seriously, but I think good comedy is harder to do than good drama.
Yeah, well, you know, it's because, you know, that's been known for a long time. You know, it's, you know, there's all sorts of probably apocryphal, you know, famous actor on his or her deathbed saying, you know, it must be hard dying. You know, dying is easy, comedy is hard.
Sure.
You know, there's probably actually a real person, but every time I hear that quoted, it's with a different actor.
Oh, it was Douglas Fairbanks. Yeah. So it was.
Although, you know, I believe, and I haven't been able to find out this is false, but the best way to find out when you're wrong about something is to say it publicly. And you,
do you mean, is there some sort of a delivery system where people would let you know to your face that what you're saying is not true?
No, but it's really, it's really true in religious discussions,
mm-hmm.
that I believe that the people that say we won't talk about religion, we won't talk about this, I have my feelings, you have yours, we'll be respectful. What they're really saying is, don't bust me, I won't bust you.
Right.
And if you really care about the truth, which I believe that many fundamentalist Christians, evangelical Christians, who are the people I want to talk to, they really believe the truth.
Mm-hmm.
They will say it, and they will talk to you, and they will be eager to learn. And that's why you get, you know, people from evangelical backgrounds, when they go atheist really intellectually, not emotionally. They don't slide into it. They really make a decision. And I believe that what we call tolerance is actually just a fear of being proven wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you state what you believe over and over again loudly, you will get busted every single time. And right now, you know, when this thing, when people listen to this thing, I will get tweets that correct every point of view. Dean Martin did not do the spotlight joke in 1987. He only did that in 91. It was the third time you saw him, not the first time, Penn. Asshole. Boom.
Weird that person would know all those things.
Except in 140 characters.
Sure.
They'll be able to do that.
Hashtag boom.
Yeah, hashtag. Hashtag Penn is wrong.
Is that a hashtag? I bet it is.
It is. Oh, sure. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I made this stupid mistake. I was on, you know, pimping the Celebrity Apprentice.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted a mission, and for my sins, they gave me one. and I was on with Adam Carolla, and I told this completely false story about there not being a Nobel Prize in math. It was one that I'd heard, you know, over supper, you know, from a friend. And I had never checked it. I hadn't gone to Snopes. I didn't expect to bring it up.
Yeah.
But it came up, talking to Adam Carolla. And I told this story, which is a great, great story. Not true. Often true of great stories.
Sure.
Not true. And then immediately, you know, I get up from the interview and I have, you know, 40 tweets saying that story's bullshit. And I type in immediately, I was wrong. That story is bullshit. And still, they re-show that, and I get another 40 things going, that's the wrong. So I believe Oscar Wilde, and just get ready. They already got, now right now, as people are listening, they have their finger, and this, and you know, this podcast is called Nerdist.
Yes,
and
sir.
there's a pejorative built into the word nerd, which I guess has turned around almost completely.
Yeah.
But when I say about these people that are listening and have their fingers on the keyboard, it is not in any way, it's just respect and also humbled that people care enough to do that. But they've already got Oscar Wilde into the Google thing there. They've already got that.
That wasn't either Those Curtains Go or I Do?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes. Now, do you think that's true?
I don't know.
You're going to find out.
I like believing it's true because, you know, it's I like the idea, and I think it's one of the reasons why I love Doctor Who so much.
Oh, yeah.
Is creating mythology with real-life reference points.
Mm-hmm.
I love that. I love that. I will totally see Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter. You know, like, I love the creation of mythology that are based in real people, even if all the facts. So, like, with the Oscar Wilde thing, I don't know if he said it, but I love the idea of it so much.
What I love is that the hashtag just changed to Chris is wrong.
There is plenty of that.
I love that.
You know what? I love your point about do you feel because you're so outspoken about things and because you very freely share, you say what you believe.
I try.
You absolutely say what you believe, and when you're wrong, you say I'm wrong. When you think you're right, you say I'm right. Do you? How are you sort of emotionally shielded from people, you know, running up to you so much and be like, you're a fucking piece of shit, you don't know what you're fucking talking about, you goddamn idiot. Like, how do you...
You know, that's something I was just talking, you know, that you talk about all the time. You know, there's this sense of thick-skinned. You know, people will tell you Howard Stern has a thick skin, you know, Sam Kennison, you know, nothing bothered him. You could say anything to him you wanted. And people say, you know, you have a thick skin. People can run up and say you're fucking wrong. I believe that is absolutely not true. There's a, you know, a kind of a parable about, parable's not the right word, but there's a story about bravery where a young soldier is talking to an older soldier, and the older soldier is trembling. And the younger soldier says, you're trembling. I thought you were brave. And the older soldier says, if you understood the situation the way I do, you wouldn't be here. That's bravery.
Oh, wow.
Bravery is not the absence of fear. Bravery is action in the presence of fear. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge difference. And I believe that everything people say about every insult comic, Lisa Lampanelli, mm-hmm. I'll use an example. Everything they say that's hurtful to her hurts her exactly as much as whoever you want to see is the most tender, you know, 14-year-old mall girl in the Midwest. The amount of pain is exactly the same. It's just working through it. And I feel like it's unfair. You know, I'll do an appearance on something. You know, and I have a lot of followers on Twitter. And I do this nutty thing where I try. You know, when the Celebrity Apprentices hits and, you know, when my podcast Sunday School first hit, I get 800 tweets, and I try to answer them all, but I can't. But on a regular day-to-day basis, I try to answer every tweet that requires an answer personally. And I will find that I do 25 thank yous in a row. You know, thank you, thank you. And some stuff remarkable, like people that, you know, really reacted to the atheism of my book and really beautiful stuff and talking about, you know, death of a loved one, which I talk about a lot, and so on. And I write thanks. And then one person writes one thing like, you know, I'll give you an example. Your answers, I just did this thing called 5 minutes with Obama. What would you say to Obama if you had 5 minutes with him, mm-hmm. you know? And all I hit on that was peace. Stop killing people. That's all I care about, really. Stop killing people. And somebody wrote, your answer seemed insincere.
Oh, that must really, that is the core of your being. Because you, from what I know about you, you always try to be sincere and honest.
Of course I fail. And I'm always failing.
That's right? Way worse than saying you're a fucking idiot, because that that gets at the very core of who you are.
I get something that says, my mother died. Reading your book helped me through it. Thank you so much. And I write back, I'm sorry for your loss. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Means a lot. Guy writes one sentence on, you seemed insincere on this. My glasses come off. I put my hand up my face. I go back and I say, what did I say? I read it over again and I go, well, yeah, there's a turn of phrase in there that maybe I tried to put wit ahead of what I was actually feeling, but that's what I'm really feeling. And they gave me, you know, all the stuff he doesn't know, like when they give you the thing you have to answer the questions on, this is the number of sentences you can use. Mm-hmm. You know, there's all these kind of rules, what paper it's going to be for and all of that. And I just feel, while I'm doing it and feeling bad, I also feel tremendously guilty because it is pissing in the face of everyone that said something kind. You know, a person writes about his mother's fucking death and has me in there as helping them through it. You know, what could be more vulnerable? What could be more offering up in cyberspace to Twitter? How can you offer up that kind of pure, raw emotion to a stranger in Twitter? And it takes me the amount of time to process that. Thanks means a lot. You were a little bit insecure. Oh, okay. There's a Freudian slip. Whoa! Okay. Well, we just explained that whole thing.
Well, there we go. I think we've peeled back the flesh to get the juicy organs inside. But I do think that you're not taking into the emotional equation what that guy's frame of mind was.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, he just got beaten up by his girlfriend.
Right.
You know? I don't know what happened. That's the thing I always like to point out. You know, spousal abuse is about 50-50.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know. And
so the one side of it doesn't go as reported because...
I don't know, you know, but if you go to, you know, emergency rooms and stuff, it's, you know, and I have one of my dearest friends was stabbed in the back by his wife.
Oh, my.
With a knife. In the back. Stabbed in the back.
Was it Tom
Now,
Arnold?
The number of people that I've met personally been stabbed in the back is one. And I know 8 people who've been shot. Okay, I know one guy's been stabbed in the back, and it was by a spouse
who
took a knife and buried it into his back. And he was too embarrassed to go to the emergency room. So he has this big, gnarly scar. You know, he's 76 years old and has this big, gnarly scar where it looks like someone stabbed him in the back with a kitchen knife.
I love the second after that happened where I was like, blah. And then he's like, oh, I can't go to the hospital for this. Oh, what did you do that for? It's like just it's so inconvenient.
I had a friend, one of the best close-up magicians that ever lived, named Jerry Camaro. And Jerry Camaro, I can tell stories about Jerry Camaro forever. Jerry Camaro rode with a motorcycle gang called the Huns.
Okay.
And the Huns were a gang in, I guess, the 60s and 70s. I may get some of these facts wrong. They're out of Connecticut. And they're the ones, you know, you want a definition of some sort of badass.
Sure.
Stupid badass. Some sort of definition. They're the ones that stole $1 million in arms from the Black Panthers.
Okay.
Then sold them back to them.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I have a lot of trouble thinking of something stupider than that.
Yeah.
But he was Sergeant of Arms at that time. Okay. Jerry Camaro. That's the kind of tough guy he was. And he was a close-up magician, right? And
how he got the arms. He just all the guns.
Well, that was the whole thing. He did this perfect bottom deal. And, you know, a bottom deal is impossible because what you're trying to do with a bottom deal is you want to deal cards off the bottom of the deck that look like they're coming off the top so that the top card that you're controlling can be dealt to you or to anybody you want to. That's what a bottom deal accomplishes. Okay. And a bottom deal is impossible because your eye can't see it coming from the bottom instead of the top, but you can see all the body language, and you can also hear the sound. The sound of a card being dealt, like, you know, sports people say baseball, that outfielders can tell. I don't know why I'm using a sports analogy. I don't understand it. But they can tell where the ball is going from the sound of the bat, the sound of the ball hitting the bat. So the sound of the card coming off. I can tell if someone's doing a false deal or a false shuffle without looking in that direction. You can just hear it. And Jerry's were perfect. Perfect, perfect deals. And he would travel around doing workshops for other magicians, teaching his bottom deal. And I would go and watch him do these things. And I would say to him afterwards, but you don't give them the most important thing about your perfect bottom deal. And he said, what's that? I go, you did 14 years in prison for murder one. You cannot do a perfect bottom deal without doing at least 15, 12, maybe, years in prison for murder one. You need to sit in a cell with a deck of cards, and you need to do that longer than anyone has the willpower to do. So if you want to learn a perfect bottom deal, and I know you do.
I do.
My advice is, first kill a motherfucker.
Okay.
Get caught.
Mm-hmm.
20 years from now, you'll have a perfect, perfect bottom deal.
Now you're going to do that in some bad twist. They're going to take your cards away. And then
Then he'll also be good at ATM. You know, all those things.
That's a given.
The whole thing.
That's a given.
Already good at it, guys.
Jerry would do this trick. You know, he worked in a tuxedo, right? Because he got out of prison, they let him out of the gang, and he went to do close-up magic. He would work at these classy places.
That's the most insane story I've ever heard.
With a tuxedo, right? And he would be out there doing tricks, and he would get like a yuppie asshole. This is in the 80s, yeah. Heckling him, right? And when he got this asshole heckling him, he would come out, and he'd roll up his sleeves and say, "Watch this." And he would do this ace trick that was stunning. And from the moment he started the ace trick, the guy would shut up, and he would own the whole room. You know, this is close up, so 10, yeah. 15 people. He would own all of them, and the heckler would never heckle him again. And he would talk about this ace trick as his absolute heckler stopper. So he's coming back. He's working the same place, Magic Island or something, you know, one of those places, Magic Castle or something. And we're back in the break room, and I just watched his set. And Jerry says to me, "You know, Penn, that ace trick I do, you saw I had that asshole there, stops him dead every time. That ace trick, man, they don't say another word." I said, "Jerry, it's not the trick." He goes, "What do you mean it's not the trick?" I go, "It doesn't matter what trick you did there." He goes, "What are you talking about, man? What are you talking about?" I said, "You roll up your sleeves when you do that." He goes, "Yeah, that's to show them that there's none of that bullshit with the sleeves or stuff." I said, "No, that shows them your Jailhouse Ink. It says on your wrist, 'Fuck the world.' And there's Dennis the Menace on a trike, and you have all the colors from the Huns. And even a yuppie idiot knows the difference between mall ink and Jailhouse Ink." I said, "The color isn't consistent. The lines are awful. It's obviously done with, you know, a mixture of like shit and newspaper with a needle hooked to a cassette recorder. And you roll your sleeve up," and the guy goes, "Hey, listen.
Oh, good trick. It's a good trick."
Never understood that. And Jerry Camaro told me he had been shot 4 times and stabbed 5 or 6. You could see I was around him when he would change and he would take off his shirt and there were bullet holes and like knife wounds into him. And he said to me one of the most chilling things anyone has ever said to me. He said, "You know, Penn, if you're ever given a choice between being shot and being stabbed, go with the shot because a knife hurts going in, coming out, and all the time in between."
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Now, that makes my stomach drop out.
He's probably said it very matter-of-factly.
And I say, as a joke to him, "Yeah, but how often do they give you a choice?" And he says, "Sometimes they do."
Was he a sociopath? Was Jerry Camaro a sociopath performer?
I think he was.
That's
what I mean, sometimes there's the choice. Oh, fuck Sophie. Give up one of your kids in a second. You want to be shot or you want to be stabbed? Give me a while to think about this.
Well, that's a fucked up, because usually when you think about being attacked, it doesn't ever seem really calculated. It's just like, oh, this skirmish happened. But if someone is offering you a choice, there's a whole other level of fucked up-itness that is occurring.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You'll wake up screaming in the middle of the night thinking about that. There will be a dream when you're at the bowling alley with Dad. And some guy says, you know, "You want to be shot or you want to be stabbed?" You say, "Give me a minute.
Give me a minute." Now we all know the answer.
We know the answer. Yeah, the answer is you want to get shot.
You want to shoot right here. Just get it clean. Just get it clean through.
Don't point directly to your heart.
No.
How high are you?
Heart's here. Just like in the shoulder, maybe. Okay, in the shoulder.
Go higher.
Yeah, go higher.
I don't know. But point to that place. Point to the place in your body where you want to get shot.
I don't know. It's a hard one. Does it go through here? Like it goes all the way through here?
No, those are vital organs.
Oh, no. You want to go thigh.
Thigh.
Yeah, you want your thigh shot.
Thigh?
Or ass.
You want ass shot, you think?
Well, you need muscle.
Yeah?
Because that's going to heal faster.
Okay. And he's known at the gym as muscle ass.
Yeah, that's what they call me.
he's on the rowing machine just like...
Well, it's
like
the muscle ass or ATM machine.
Your ATM machine at the gym. I want to ask you, because we have about 10 more minutes with you, I want to ask you about Amazing Meeting, because I forgot to do it last time, because my friend Adam Savage is
good guy.
And Paul Provenza also are very involved with Amazing Meeting, which happens every year in Vegas.
It does.
So just tell me a little bit about, tell us a little bit about Amazing Meeting.
Well, you know who Amazing Randy is.
Yes.
James Randy. I guess you're not really asking me this. You probably know most of it.
I know a lot of it. I just want you to tell the people.
You know, Amazing Randy created Penn & Teller. You know, when I was 18, I went and saw James Randi give a lecture. And the idea is that the worst thing you can do is to lie to another person. And I mean really lie. I don't mean something you believe or a little half-assed lie. But one of the most powerful things you can do is just say an untruth. And when I was 18, I had been burned very badly by a magician, Kreskin, a mentalist who led me to believe that there was ESP. And I had completely conflated. I guess you didn't even conflate it. I mean, they were the same to me, lying to an audience on stage and lying one-on-one to a person. And I was very against that and still am. And Amazing Randi did this show where he talked about lying being okay within the proscenium and not okay outside of it. So once I'm telling you in the Penn and Teller show that I'm going to lie to you, and you know that, it's okay. I go a step further and say that I don't want anyone to leave our show with a misunderstanding about the world around them. So we can saw a woman into halves, and then you leave and know we haven't killed her.
Mm-hmm.
But that also has to be true with mentalism. You can't think that I did a trick with memorization or reading body language that was actually done with a slip force. You know, I can't do that. That's not right. So that's a hard thing to keep, by the way. That's a hard level to keep, because it's so nice to be able to go, I read your body language on that, because it might cover up, the fact you did a shitty move.
Right.
So Randi changed. And that's a huge thing about Randi and about Houdini. Elvis Presley doesn't really make a change in the philosophy of what he's doing. If you want to talk about what's great about Elvis, great voice, sexy, but more important than that, culturally, doing an awful lot. And I mean, I guess this could be argued with, but an awful lot for racial harmony. I mean, he did make black and white music the same. He did mix those together. Someone had to do it. Whether it happened to be Elvis or he actually did it, that's a big thing. But he didn't change from there to something else. What Houdini did was started out as an escape artist. I defy the jails of the world to hold me. And then changed to there is no afterlife.
Right.
Pretty heavy.
He was disproving people.
Yeah, he was busting people. And Randi did that same thing. He went from escape artist to someone who worked with scientists and talked about how, essentially said, when you're testing paranormal claims, you do need all the scientists there, but you also need a magician, because test tubes don't lie to you.
Yeah.
And people do. We need to do this. So he set up, over the years, he went from just James Randi and nut would go on Tom Snyder and say, Uri Geller might be doing magic tricks, to the James Randi Educational Foundation, which is now thousands of people and is out of Florida and has a board of directors, which, how many things are you involved with that have a board of directors?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
That's pretty rare.
I have a board of directors. And Randi becomes this kind of figurehead, and they do whatever you want to call it, ghost busting, skepticism, whatever. And then every year, and they do it, they've done one in Australia, they've done one in England, they tried one in Florida, but mostly it's Vegas, the bellwether of skepticism. this year it's in July. I know because Friday the 13th of July, my band is doing the Penn's Bacon and Donut Party.
Awesome.
Which is not affiliated in any way with the James Randi Educational Foundation.
I'm going to go to that.
I keep that separate.
Sounds like fun.
Because I don't want Randi to have to answer for what I do. Because if he does, so I pay for everything. I pay for the lights, the sound, the band, the bacons, the donuts, everything. And you're welcome to come in, anybody that's at TAM or anybody that's even in Vegas. I invite everybody. The doors are wide open. I had about 1,300 people last year. I got a six-piece band. We play rock and roll, atheist rock and roll, for an hour and a half. Then I asked people to just give money to Randi.
2, 3, 4.
But the real speakers, they've had, of course, Christopher Hitchens, mm-hmm. and Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris and all the horsemen of, put Dennett in there, the four horsemen of the atheist. And I've also gotten Trey and Matt.
Oh, wow.
Trey Parker and Matt Stone showed up and lectured. Because, you know, the best skeptical show ever done on TV was the John Edward episode of South Park.
So good.
And Teller and I tried for 20 years to explain cold reading and explain talking to the dead and took our best shots at it and did some really, really good stuff. And then were completely and utterly creamed by Matt and Trey, who were 1,000 times better than us. And now when people come to us as the experts on cold reading, I go, watch the South Park.
Here, it's on, it's on the internet. You can just go watch it.
Just better than us.
I remember watching a documentary in the early 90s that always stuck with me about James Randi. And one of the things that he did was, I think he said, and again, I'm sure the internet will tell me if I'm wrong, or you maybe know this, but he said he was making his money when he was younger. He was doing readings for people, like tarot card readings. And just as an experiment, he started telling people the opposite of what the cards were actually saying. And he said, without fail, people would always find a connection to it.
Always, yeah. You know, Randi, there's a really cool trick, and this is one thing that's not covered by South Park. So I'll add a little bit to the cold reading thing. There's two tricks to cold reading that are really phenomenal, and they're both kind of poetic. One is, any cold reading you do, just say everything and take it back. Works perfectly. But do a cold reading on you.
Oh,
you're very outgoing, but there's a shy side of you as well. You like to be around people, but you value your alone time. You're in the public eye. But there's a big part of you that doesn't want to be.
You're just covering every base. Yeah,
well, you're just saying you're a tall guy, but you're also,
because they're going to hear what they connect to.
Sure, sure. And then the other thing, and this
guys,
is,
there was something to this. He was correct.
I see you walking with all the other children, but somehow you're different.
This is exactly me.
You have a scar on your left knee.
Oh, my God.
That's almost always true for everybody. The other one that I love is have five people in your family. Because everyone has five people in their family. You just don't define family. You know, mother, father, two siblings, and you.
Right.
Or you don't count you. Or you count the grandmother that lived with you.
Don't count me.
Oh, that's insane.
Yeah. If you're an only child, you have five people because you had two grandparents that were close to you. if you get a single mom, there's the aunt that helps you out and her best friend. It's always five people. It's
that's
great.
Hilarious.
And the other thing is you just search your heart and say in general terms what you feel about yourself. And the truth is that cold readings are just bad poetry. And they work for the same reason poetry works, which is that we share a heart that's very, very similar. You know, there's that great quote from, they'll correct me, Plato, I think, who says, be kind, everyone's fighting a hard fight.
Mm-hmm. Thought he was going to say rewind.
I believe it was Plato.
Be kind.
Matt, you have scored, my friend.
Thank you.
It's good.
That was
fantastic. Come in, hit a home
but
run.
You know, we all have the same insecurities, the same battles, the same everything, and that comes out in cold reading. So for 3 or 4 days on that weekend in July, starting the Friday the 13th, at the South Coast Plaza.
I can't believe Nerdist is going to pay for me to go out and cover this for the website. This
they
is
should.
Amazing.
Well, I will, actually.
Okay, good.
I'll send you to Vegas to cover
them. The other thing you can do is you can bang out some shows with incredible guests.
Oh, hey. Let's do that.
There's no chance of you having Dawkins come into the studio.
No, he's not coming to E.
But you can get Dawkins there.
That would be pretty crazy.
I mean, we went there when I was doing my radio. You know, and I'm doing a podcast now, so I'll be there. I'm doing a podcast called Penn Sunday School.
Yeah.
And I'll be doing it from there then. And, you know, we did the radio show. Godot and I had, you know, Hitchens, Dawkins, and Sam Harris on. Those are 3 weeks in a row. You know, just hardcore great, great, great interviews. It was wonderful. But it's really a good time. And it also has that, you know, you just don't get to be around those kinds of like-minded people that often. You know, to have over 1,000 people, not one of whom is going to talk to you about astrology in a positive way.
Unless you're on Reddit.
Right.
But then, yeah. it's a pretty beautiful situation. And I used to be, you know, we did 10 years of Penn and Teller doing Q&As or doing little shows and shit until everybody there had seen everything that we could possibly do and ask us every question possible. And then I just put together a rock and roll band. That was my solution.
You should have just called the Q&A.
Yeah.
It was our Q&A.
And, you know, we had we did Viva Las Vegas and had strippers.
I mean,
Skeptical strippers is pretty cool.
That's pretty great.
Yeah.
They don't, because everything they're doing, you can prove because
right, they're saying. And the strippers don't say afterwards, this is my first day working here.
I'm not a religious person. I was raised Catholic. But I also, I don't have anything against religious. I mean, like I have friends who are very spiritual. And the only time I ever get crusty is when people get super judgy about, like, you know, when they do the, you're wrong, or I'm going to condescend you because you're going to, I mean, isn't that, I don't really know what's what. I know what I believe, and I know, you know, I guess it's kind of what you said earlier about, like, you believe what you want, that makes you happy, it's true to you because you believe that.
Yeah, well, it depends, you know, it depends. The difference of opinion there is whether you want to change what you feel to get closer to the truth, or whether you want to embrace it and not let it go.
Right.
And I think that the people that tend to be insulted that they are more judgmental are actually the people who are changing their minds and going closer to truth. I mean, if you are outspoken, people will slap you down.
Sure.
And that's a really good way to learn.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the ways I went from being kind of a straight liberal to being libertarian was just friends of mine who I would say something, they'd say, shut up, you're wrong. You're just wrong. You know, and until I started saying stuff, I didn't get a chance to be proven wrong.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I try to be outspoken because, boy, that's the quickest way to get information. If you sit comfortable with your beliefs and keep your mouth shut, you will keep those beliefs the rest of your life.
That's an interesting point.
If you speak out about them, people will slap you down.
I do like that point that if you are actually seeking the truth, that you are comfortable with being wrong because ultimately the truth is what you want, not something that just confirm, or at least in your mind, confirms a set of beliefs that you already have.
It's hard to do, but it's such a great feeling. The saying, I'm wrong.
Right.
It's just this great, great feeling.
Because you get to learn.
Yeah, you get to learn, and it's really hard at first, and then you can just get really, really good at it if you are, like me, wrong all the time. You get good at going, oh, yeah, that's not how the Nobel Prize math happened. Sorry.
I mean, in a way, I think the internet is good for that, is that, you know, there was a generation of people who were totally isolated from the public, and so, like, performers, and so they, you know, they kind of lived in these weird sort of isolated bubbles. And now the internet is sort of the, it just keeps you in check. It just keeps you in check.
You know, the idea, and I would have been wrong about that. You know, the idea of crowd intelligence, you know, just simply Wikipedia,
mm-hmm.
and all that Wikipedia means, I would have been, and indeed was, very skeptical of that working. And, you know, every Wikipedia page has a few mistakes. But boy, on the overall thrust, it's pretty right. You know, I was talking to a friend of mine who said, you know, they have my birthday wrong, the name of one of my children wrong. They got, and I said, but yeah, but everything they want to really know about you, you can get on that Wikipedia page. The when we all work together and think together, it is astonishing how much we accomplish. I'm one of the people that thinks that there is absolutely nothing but good in the internet. I think there's nothing but good in freedom of speech. I don't put any caveats on it at all. I mean, including all the comments and you're stupid,
you're a better person than I, yeah. Because I see stuff sometime online like, that guy shouldn't be allowed to express that. Why does that guy have a voice? That's the worst thing I've ever read.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
I guess that's just part of the thing that makes the system work.
And I like that. I mean, I like the fact that it's all real checks and balances and not at all top down.
Yeah.
You know, the idea that it really is so purely egalitarian. And I think in a certain way, kind of a meritocracy. You know,
yeah.
It's amazing the way,
of course it is.
If someone is saying crazy, crazy shit, the system, you know, no rules, but just the people kind of just shut up.
That's what I love about Reddit. It is that it is a pure meritocracy for that community.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, Reddit is
the front page is like thing after thing. You're like, yep, that's amazing. Well, yeah, that's fucking great, too. Oh, my God. And they, you know, like everyone, the cream rises on that.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. It's just great how, and I also love that you can, you know, you can just, you know, I actually, you know, I was going to say graduated. That wouldn't be accurate. I get out of high school in 73. So I used to have to, you know, if Frank Zappa mentioned, you know, if Lou Reed mentioned Delmore Schwartz or Frank Zappa mentioned Kafka in the Penal Colony, I had to get on my bicycle or later on get in my car, drive to the library, and then go through and find this shit. I cannot imagine how wonderful it would have been to just listen to music, hear a reference, type in to find out the lyrics, and then go and say, oh, I'm supposed to read In the Penal Colony by Kafka. Boom, doop, boom, pull it up. Unbelievable. Because the library, and I just kicked you. The library was to me the most beautiful place in the world. And now I have one with me all the time in my shirt pocket.
We're basically walking at libraries of Alexandria at all
exactly,
times.
Exactly, all of us.
And soon you won't even be typing. There's already augmented reality. You could just, a song is playing, you hold up your thing, it gives you all the information you need to know, like
the
Shazam.
Just go.
It's fucking
just
crazy.
And I still don't know how. Do you know how Shazam works?
I have guessed how it works, which is that, you know, every song has a specific waveform that is as unique as...
Yeah, but it doesn't know when it's stopping and starting. That's what drives me crazy.
I guess it just takes a sample.
Yeah, I guess so.
And then just quickly matches that waveform.
Yeah.
I'm sure I could easily find out how it works, but I'm going to speculate because that's what we do.
Exactly.
No.
But now the Google glasses. What about the Google glasses?
The Google glasses are fascinating to me, but the only thing that I can't get around is, does that mean you're constantly going to have to, like, up and down and left? Everyone's going to have fucked up necks from navigating with their heads.
They'll be strong. Like the people that milk cows.
That'll be a new euphemism. Like, I got a Google neck. Your fucking Google necks coming in here and looking at the internet with our goddamn glasses. Get out of here, you fucking Google necks. We'll figure out a way to be racist against it somehow.
Google necks.
Google necks.
I just think it's gonna be great.
Well, we're at the end of our hour with you. Do you have anything you want to promote?
Yes, I'm starting a new podcast.
Sunday School.
Penn Sunday School. And you can go to pennsundayschool.com. It's also on iTunes and everywhere else.
Yeah.
But it's Penn Sunday School. It's every Sunday. We do it live with about 1,000 people. I was going to leave it at 666 for the number of people in the congregation, but we have actually many more than that. We had like 2,700 or something that are there live so that we can read what they're saying and all the chat and all of that. And then it goes up. That's Sunday at noon, Vegas time.
Mm-hmm.
And then it goes up at about 5 o'clock p.m. Sunday as a podcast on iTunes and everything. And the great thing, and this has made me so happy, is you can go to pennsundayschool.com or pennsundayschool.com, because I didn't know how I was going to tell people how many S's to put between Penn and Unday.
So you can take your
one
pick.
Or two S's between Penn and Unday. It's up to you. And we try to keep it, you know, it's a very, very focused podcast. We try to talk about monkeys, God, and the Supreme Court.
Okay.
We try to keep it with those three things. Because that's...
They're all the same thing.
When it all comes down, those are the three things I care about most.
Yeah.
Monkeys, God, and the Supreme Court.
And they weirdly all tie together.
They certainly do, in my heart.
Yeah.
And what have we learned? If you have a choice of being stabbed or being shot.
You want to be shot.
I was shot. And it's ATM, not ATM machine.
Sociopaths make the best performers.
And the best sex partners.
That's
and
right.
I have a muscular ass.
Yeah.
Yep.
Those are all the things we learned today.
Oh, I love that. It's nice when we can actually learn stuff on the podcast. We all walk away from here feeling much in the same way you did at a little show in the late 1980s when you saw Dean Martin perform.
Dean Martin is so good.
Now I want to go back and watch every performance and study him.
You're going to go crazy. You're going to love it. You're going to just love it.
You'll come back on again at some point, right?
Why wouldn't I?
I love like having you on.
We'll have him on in July when we're in Vegas.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah, we'll come to Amazing Meeting. Or if I'm working, I'll send Matt. Like, some one of us will be there. Or
sure.
All of us will be there.
Yeah, that'll be good. It'll be good, good, good.
All right, cool. Thanks, man. Good to see
you. Okay, thank you. Good to see you.
Enjoy your burrito, everyone.
Now leaving Nerdist.com.